in lane number three. This will be the halfway stage for Jazz Carlin and Ellie Faulkner and Jessica Thielman. And now the gap is up to about a second and a half between Jazz Carlin and Ellie Faulkner. As you can see, it's just edging away. And Ellie just needs to hold on here because they could both get that time. They should both get this time of 8:29.55 to get on the plane to Barcelona in a few weeks' time.
They're both capable of it, but you can see now Jazz is clearly moving ahead. Her tactics probably was to try and take it out reasonably easy for the first 200 and then lay the hammer down. Jessica Thielman trains and lives out in Florida. She actually trains with Ryan Lochte, so expect her to come back very fast because they do an incredible amount of work out there in Florida.
Well, she's finding that third place is quite a lonely place to be because she doesn't see anybody else in and around her to race. Nor does Jess Carlin now, because look, she's just put in a huge leg kick and has started to move two or three body lengths ahead of Ellie Faulkner as they come into 500. 300 meters still to go when they turn this time, but there will be a much bigger lead for Jazz Carlin over Ellie Faulkner at this turn. It's up to 2.5 seconds now between Jazz and Ellie Faulkner. That was a real breaker, wasn't it? That 100 there, she just went, certainly that last 50, she went for it.
So you see a lot of swimmers break an 800 down in 400 and 400, and it looks like that's what Jazz has done. She's taken the first 400 out quick, but now she's trying a negative split. By that, I mean she's trying the second 400 to be faster than the 400, and that's something that Jazz is really, really good at doing, something that she works incredibly a lot on with Bud, her coach, down in Swansea. And you can see at the minute she's 5 or 6 metres ahead, and this is Jazz's race to win.
Yeah, I don't see anybody getting close. It's now down to Ellie Faulkner just to put her head down and keep going and hope that this is a very, very quick time. And it is going to be a quick time, too, for Jazz Carlin. Is she going to break the record that she set, the Welsh record that she set back in Leeds in March? She's certainly going for it. Ellie Faulkner, to her credit, is trying to hang on in there. And she's about 3 or 4 body lengths back. Jessica Thielman's about 5 or 6 back from her, maybe a little bit more in third place, and there's a big gap to four. So the 1-2-3 remains as it's been pretty much all the way through. Jazz Carlin has a lead of 3.5 seconds over Ellie Faulkner. She in turn leads by 6 seconds from Jessica Thielman. It's getting quite strung out here.
Per 100, Jazz is swimming around about 64 seconds, and she's got 200 left. So on that equation, you'd see Jazz to be going around about 8:22, which is inside her Welsh record and will put her second in the world rankings if she can keep this up. Your likelihood is she's going to sprint the last 100, so hopefully she can be around that 8:21, 8:22, 8:23, and that'll be an improvement on her Welsh record.
Well, I think we're on course for obviously a personal best and that Welsh record going, and we can say, I think, pretty definitely, unless she blows up, and obviously we hope sincerely she doesn't over the last part of the race, that Jazz Carlin is very, very much back. Now, she'll hear a very pleasant sound right now as she comes into the wall. There's the bell to signify 100 metres, and I'm glad to say Ellie Faulkner has not been dropped here. She's still in contention for that second place in terms of qualification.
And Jazz has just gone a 63, so this is going to be an incredibly quick race for Jazz. We saw Becky last year qualifying for the Olympic Games around about 8:18, and this is going to be around about 8:20. But like you say, Ellie Faulkner is still hanging on in there, and she's almost certainly going to go under the qualification time for the World Championships.
Yeah, she was 5 seconds shy of Jazz at that last turn. As long as it doesn't get much more than that, she'll be okay, providing Jazz does the time we think she'll do. Jess Thielman still in third place. Aisha Thornton, the crowd are getting excited. The coaches are getting excited. Bill Furness, the National Performance Director, is nodding his head in approval.
This is a world-class win from Jazz. We've witnessed her coming back from adversity, and she's got just over 20 metres to go, and this is going to be absolutely an emotional moment for Jazz and her coach and her family.
Right then, Jazz, what can you do in and around the 8:20s? Go on, you can do it. You can get there.
8:18.58.
My goodness me. 8:18.58 now. Ellie Faulkner, back it up. 8:25.36. They have both made the qualifying time. It's a huge new personal best and a Welsh record for Jazz Carlin. Ellie Faulkner in second has got the time, and that is also a new personal best for her by 2 seconds. Well done, both. Jazz Carlin, you are a star.
Number one ranked swimmer in the world as well by a good 2 seconds. That is a world-class performance swim from Jazz, and it's so great to see her after last year. She would have been out here. I should have been in tears watching the London Olympic Games, but that 8 minutes would have made up a long way for the way she felt last year. Well done, Jazz Carlin. That is an incredible swim.
Incredible being the word. There's Jazz. Cannot quite believe, I don't think, what she has just done. Extraordinary swim, that is. 8:18.58. Now remember, she did 8:24 in Leeds. She has taken a full 6 seconds. Let's see how she finished in this. Here comes the end for the number one swim in this event in the world this year.
Seeing those pictures earlier, it looks like she could have done another 800 metres. She looked hardly out of breath. That's the amount of work she puts in. And we're seeing the finish now, head down into the wall. And that you've just witnessed there, the fastest time a woman has swum the 800 metres this year. And that is world class.
Jessica Teoma with the personal best in third as well. 8:34.78. So there you have it. Jazz Carlin, Ellie Faulkner, Jessica Teoma, all personal best and a new Wales record for Jazz Carlin. What a sensational. I hope she's got her breath back, because I'm not sure we got our breath back after that. We expected maybe an 8:22, something like that, but an 8:18.58. Well, we need to hear about how it was achieved. So let's hear from Jazz Carlin now, who's on pool deck with Cassie Patton.
Jasmine Carling, fastest woman in the world this year. How does it feel?
It's a bit scary, actually. I was really nervous beforehand, but also really excited because I've been training really hard and working well with my coach. So I just wanted to get stuck in, and obviously to come away with a 6 second PB is just incredible. I didn't expect it.
So what's going to happen now between now and Barcelona?
Well, obviously, it's different this year. It's something we've never done before, but I'm obviously swimming well now, and I want to continue and hopefully go even faster in 5 weeks' time.
You're definitely swimming very well. Let's have a massive round of applause for Jasmine Carlin.
You could see Jasmine was really holding back the tears there, and it must be so hard coming back from illness, and many of the swimmers that are competing here will have to battle with injury and illness, but it's great to see that she's bouncing back as strong as ever. And I think, Ross, you can definitely agree with me here. I mean, for her to be able to come back after London 2012, even myself, I know what it's like to miss out on the games and think, how can I come back? But she has, and she's done it in style.
She certainly has done it in style. That time she just did there would have put her about third or fourth in the Olympic Games last year. Probably would have won a medal at the Olympic Games. So knowing that, sitting at home, knowing that she could compete for medals must be incredibly hard. But the way she's got on with it, she's not moaned, she's not throwing her toys out of the pram. She's quietly gone about her business. She's had a hit in funding, as you probably would expect, not being on the team. But the way she's come through, and now she's the fastest woman in the world, is a real credit to her.
And as you say about Jazz Carling, she's did a great job there. And we actually caught up with a youngster who did a great job yesterday, Ben Proud, who did a big personal best in the 50 metres freestyle and did a qualification time, just like we've just seen Jazz Carling do there. And we caught up with him a little bit earlier on today. We're joined by Ben Proud from Plymouth Leander, who had an incredible swim last night in the 50 metres freestyle, doing a qualification time to make the team for Worlds. Now, obviously, that's subject to confirmation, but you must be over the moon, Ben.
Yeah, I mean, it was surreal when I finished. Like, I touched the wall, so I was so close to the 21 barrier, which means I was under the time. But, I mean, to do it in the semis was awesome.
And, Ben, you did exactly the same time in the semi-final and the final. How can you improve going forward?
Well, I mean, neither swim were like perfect for me. The finish I could have gone better. The start was, I still need a little bit of work on, so there's always room for improvement. I mean, I've got years ahead of me to get the practice in, so.
Because you started quite late, didn't you? You've almost developed and you're quite a way behind everybody else, and you were at the trials for London. What was that like?
It was a good experience. Like, first swim and first British swimming competition. I didn't make a semi-final, which was a bit odd, but I mean, it was good to get there, and so now looking back at it, it's quite cool knowing that I stand in the same place as all the great swimmers.
And Ben, we saw you in Leeds in the British Gas International meet, and you came second to the great Anthony Irvine.
Yeah.
What experience, or how did that experience help you last night into the semi-final and the final?
Well, I mean, just knowing that I've swam against some awesome, top in the world swimmers, like, I know I can compete against someone else in Great Britain who, I mean, it's a lot closer in sort of standards to me. So.
We want to know what the elite athlete lifestyle is really like, and you did just mention to us before off cameras that you like a fry at breakfast maybe before you race. Is that the breakfast of champions?
Well, before competition, I wouldn't generally have that. I sort of cut back on the oily foods and meats and just sort of have the healthier stuff. But I mean, during everyday lifestyle, you need to get as much food in as possible, and it's always nice going for the good breakfast.
And what sort of training are you going through at the moment? How many hours are you doing a day?
It changes day to day. Sometimes it's up to 5 hours, sometimes it's just two. But I mean, it's been solid training throughout the whole year, and it's the first tape of the season, so it's the first time we've got to come off and do some fast swimming. So.
And we've seen you in great form already this week, Ben. What have we got to look forward to for the rest of the week?
I'm swimming 50 fly tomorrow, which should be, it's a fun race, but then 100 fly on Saturday, which should be a little bit more serious, going against Adam Brown, who I'm sure will swim well again. So.
Yeah, Adam's on great form, as you are as well. So the plans going forward in terms of the next 3 years into Rio, hopefully you'll make the World Championship team this year.
Yeah.
All eyes onto the Commonwealth Games next year?
Yeah, definitely. I'm starting university at Plymouth Marjon next year, so to be able to stay in Plymouth and keep the same sort of routine going should hopefully benefit my swimming for next year.
Well, it's great to have you here, Ben, and we appreciate coming to see us, and best of luck for the rest of the week.
Yeah, thank you very
much. Good luck, Ben.
That was Ben Proud there. It was his first interview he's ever done with the media, so it was great to see that he was very confident and willing to give us his honest opinion about what he's up to over the next few days and in the rest of his career. Now, while we were just watching that video, there was the medal ceremonies for the men's and women's multi-classification at 400 metres freestyle, and we didn't get the results up for the women's race, so just to confirm that Hannah Russell did take the gold medal. She did a time of 4:40, which that'll give 4 seconds faster than she went this morning. In second place was Tully Kearney, who was a new youngster coming up in the S10 category, and she came in the silver medal position. And then we had Ellie Simmons down in third, who maybe had a bit of a disappointing swim, didn't better a time this morning, is still quite a way off her personal best time. But I think she's saving it all till Montreal, so we'll look forward to that. Now, the next final coming up is the men's 800 freestyle. And now this is a slightly different set out, as it's actually called a heat declared winner. There was the first heat this morning, and the time that was competed was by Martin Kremen, who did a time of 8:08.09. So assuming that all the swimmers or the winner of the heat tonight win or beats that time, they will be the winner of this particular race. So we will head back over to Bob Ballard, who will see how the race unfolds.
Thank you, Kate. So yes, Martin Kremen did the fastest time in the only heat we had this morning. This is the 1:08 you'll see coming up in the men's 800 meters freestyle final. And look at the man in lane 8. What are you doing in lane 8, Dan Falk? You are the fastest man in this field with 8:00.18. Tom Sunter of City of Sheffield in the centre is likely to be there or thereabouts. And we'll see whether Lewis Smith can respond from a fairly poor 400 yesterday to do a better 800 here. And Jack Bunnell, our open water swimmer from Loughborough, is in lane 7. So we have the open water swimmers in 8 and 7. And there's plenty of other interest in the field, including, as I always say at this point, James Gibson, but not that James Gibson, in lane 1 for Stockport Metro, not the coach to Fran Housel and Liam Tancock. This is the 22-year-old Stockport Metro. Ready to go, all 8. Looking for a qualifying time that none of them have done yet. Nobody in this field has ever been sub 8 minutes. And the qualifying time for Barcelona is 7:59.06. So whoever wins this will definitely be doing quite a sizable PB.
Yeah, that's right. Daniel Fogg has actually been quicker through the 800 and the 1500, but it's not registered as a PB because he didn't do it in an 800 race. So he has actually been quicker, but it's not registered as a PB.
And he, as I say, will be not out of sight, out of mind, but he's going to be on the far side in lane 8. So that might just skew this race a little bit. They'll not know what he's doing. A bit like the 400 yesterday, they weren't quite sure what he was doing, and he was doing a massive PB, so we know he's in very, very good shape.
He did 6-second PB on the 400 yesterday. He's been training for the 10K open water. His main event is probably the 1500 or the 10K, so these events are a lot shorter than he's used to, so they're a sprint for him. And you can see him now, he's turning second just behind Jack Bunnell, his teammate at Loughborough University, by 2/100 of a second.
give you an idea of the personal best, because this race is not swum terribly often. Normally, of course, for Olympics and most other events, it's the men's 1500. The women do the 8s, the men do the 15. But on this occasion, for the world, it's the 8 for the men and the 15 for the women as well. So the two extra events. Tom Sunter, 8.07.51 is his personal best, but Danny Fogg, 8.00.18, nearest to that 8-minute barrier. And of course, he has to break that to get the qualifying time. Then he has a bit of a dilemma, because he'll have too many events to do when it comes to Barcelona.
Incredible. And the from going the 10K to the 400 to the 800 to the 1500, what do you do? I think his best chance are probably in the 10K. His 400 time was a massive PB and it was great, but in terms of world standard, he'll be struggling to make that final with that kind of time. So I would expect him to concentrate on the 10K, which is the first week of the World Championships. Then he'll have 5 or 6 days to recover going into the 400 and then the 1500 6 days later. So he's got a very busy day, a busy week.
Of course, what he's got to do first is achieve that qualifying time, and he's well on his way to doing it. He was leading at the 200 stage, 156.27 second, Jack Vanell, Tom Sunter in third, and Lewis Smith in fourth. Of course, all of them, even if they don't make the team for Barcelona, will be looking for sizable PBs. And the city of Sheffield have been doing pretty much PBs every time they've got in the ball this week.
They certainly have. They've really got a strong unit together with Russ Barber here in Sheffield, and they really are taking swimming to the rest of the British guys. And it's great to see, because Sheffield's a huge city and it's got fantastic facilities, and we've been waiting for them to really kick on in terms of having a swim program. Now they've got that, they've got some great swimmers, and they are really moving up the field.
Well, here's Dan Fogg going to try and break the field here at 300. He's coming in for the turn now and opening up a little bit of an advantage over Jack Burnell. It's up to just over a second now between Fogg and Burnell in second. Tom Sunter of City of Sheffield in third, Lewis Smith in fourth, and fifth is Gareth Mills of the City of Sheffield. But Fogg's going for this.
He certainly is, and you can see Jack Burnell right on the lane rope of Dan Fogg, trying to get a wave off him. If you can move across onto the lane rope and you can get the bow wave of the swimmer in the lane next to you, it does make it easier, because it is like surfing. So you can surf that wave and it's a lot more efficient. So you can see Jack, he's on that side of the lane. He's going to try and tow off Dan Fogg all the way.
At the moment, there's a gap of well over a second, almost a second and a half between Fogg and Bonello. It's not getting any bigger. These two, of course, will be in the open water in Barcelona in a few weeks' time, so they'll be in much choppier waters than this. This is nice and still and calm. No buoys to go over, no boats to manoeuvre your way around, no yellow cards being brandished during the race. This is nice and straightforward, and Danny Fogg, for somebody who's really now an open water specialist, he's got those turns down to a T. His turns are really good now.
He spent a lot of time in Loughborough with his coach Kevin Renshaw working on that, and he's just gone through in 3.55. His PB before yesterday was 3.53, so he's right on his old PB going through in the halfway. Obviously, he's moved that forward to a 3.47, so going out a good 6-7 seconds slower, he'll have a lot in the tank in the last half of the race.
Well, even at this stage, I wouldn't mind calling the fact this is going to be Danny Fogg to win it. Now, can we get two people under 8 minutes? That would be nice to see. It's a lot to ask, though, because, as I say, for an event that's not run terribly often, the British record holder is David Davis, of course, now retired, 7:44.32. That would have been with a suit. I don't think we're going to get anywhere near that, but you never know. I won't make this kind of prediction again. Lewis Smith is the Scottish record holder. And 8.04.75 is his best time. Let's just look at the gap now that's opening up. It's about 2 to 3 body length advantage that Danny Fogg has over Jack Burnell. Tom Sunter remains in third place, going pretty well. Lewis Smith likewise in fourth. But it's all about the man in lane number 8 who is not holding back and is not going to stop for anybody at this stage.
He certainly isn't. This is Dan Fogg's race to win, and also Jack Burnell to come second. Jack's problem is going to be the time. See if he can get under that qualification time of 7:59.06. Both trained together with Kevin Renshaw, and the assistant coach there is somebody called Graham Smith.
Yes, he knows a bit about distance swimming. Our bronze medalist from 1996. And of course, he did pretty well in Fukuoka in 2001 as well. Got a medal in this event and in the 1500 as well. He got medals in both events in the World Championships that year. after coming after missing out on 2000. Amazing recovery by Graham, so he knows how to help people recover. But the gap now between first and second is up to 3.5 seconds more between Dan Fogg and Jack Bennell in second. Tom Sander holding on to third. About a second between him and Lewis Smith in fourth, but it's all about the man in lane number eight.
Certainly, he's coming into his turn. He's wrapping around about 59 seconds, so if he can keep that going with the fast last 100, he'll be somewhere around about 7.51, and that'll put him around fifth or sixth in the world this year.
Best time by Ryan Cochrane of Canada, 7.43.61, then Yang of China, Gregorio Paltrinieri of Italy, and then Gabriele Detti of Italy, and Conor Yeager of the USA. They're the top five in 2013 so far, but Dan Fogg is repping in a very good way. He's getting faster, if anything, and he is dropping Jack Bennell. He's a long, long way clear. Bennell with 100 to go. This is looking like a very, very quick time. Certainly well inside 8 minutes from Danny Fogg. 6:53.52. There's now 5 seconds between him and Jack Bennell. Tom Sunter in third and Lewis Smith in fourth.
There's certainly no doubt who's going to win this and who's going to come second. It's going to be extremely close for Jack Bennell if he makes that qualification time. He has to come back in 60.5. And he's just been going over the 61 seconds, but you'd expect the last 100. He has picked it up a little bit, but there's no doubt Dan Fogg's going to win this race with 45 metres to go.
Well, we're certainly looking at around a 7.50, maybe even better here from Dan Fogg. Bring him home with just 35 metres to go. This is all about him swimming his own race, and as you can see, there's a massive gap between two very, very good swimmers here. Dan Fogg in first place, Jack Bennell in second. The question is, what kind of time? We're just past 7.47, 48, 49. He's inside 8 minutes quite easily, 7.51.60. Come on, Jack, get in there, boy. Second place, 7.58.29. They both made the time. Dan Fogg, 7.51.60, a big new personal best, and also an English record for him. Second place, Jack Bennell. Third, Tom Sunter, 8.03.01. 4 second PB for him. And Lewis Smith with a new Scottish record of 8.04.46. All these records are just tumbling here. Dan Fogg, new English record, and two making it through to Barcelona, if selected, of course. Dan Fogg and Jack Bennell both were the quickest times over there. There's James Bond for you.
Both at the same program at Loughborough University. You can see this is the turn you're talking about earlier. Bob is going 5 metres underwater for a distance swimmer. That's quite a lot. He's coming into the finish now, head down, straight into the wall. Cracking swim from Dan Fogg. A new English record, a new PB for him, 7.51.60. Also, Jack Bennell, 7.58.29. That's also inside the qualification time, and a huge PB for Jack. Both of these guys are swimming incredibly well, and both of these guys will be representing Great Britain in the 10K as well.
Multi-talented, multi-disciplined, and Barcelona on the horizon for both of them. There already was, of course, with the open water, so they'll have to think about being indoors and outdoors as well. Great time, 7.51.60 for Dan Fogg, 7.58.29 for Jack Bennell. Another double triumph for Loughborough University to get two swimmers onto the team for the pool swimming. Dan Fogg and Jack Bennell, and of course, good times from Smith and Sunter as well. Let's hear what Dan Fogg has to say. He's with Cassie Patton.
So joining me is Daniel Fogg. Now, this is the second night of finals, the second qualifying time you've got for the World Championships. You've already qualified for the 10K. What are you going to do?
It's a good position to be in to qualify for all the events and then sit down and decide which ones I'm going to swim. The 800 is a bit of a weird one because we never swim it really. It's only at the World Champs. It's not an Olympic event. Everything's aimed towards the 1500 and the 10K, so everything else in the pool is a bonus.
Well, you're going to be very busy, and that's a good position to be in, so let's have a massive round of applause for Daniel Fogg.
Good stuff for Dan. And of course, here comes the confirmation of that result for you. New English record and qualification time for Dan Fogg, 7.51.60. New personal best, Jack Bennell. New personal best, Tom Sunter. New Scottish record for Lewis Smith in fourth place.
Just going back to the women's 800, Bob. The time Jazz Carlin did was faster than the time Becky Adlington did last year to get a bronze medal at the Olympic Games. So that would have been incredibly hard for her to sit there and watch and knowing that she could have got a medal. But the way she's come back and the way she's bounced back is absolutely incredible.
Yeah, I think so. I think it's the story of the year for me. Definitely a girl who was absolutely down and out in terms of how she felt, not being able to swim, not being able to compete properly, and really had to write off 2012. And did she come back with a bang in March of 2013? We saw her in Leeds, and then we've seen her back it up and how here in Sheffield as well. Brilliant stuff from Jazz Carlin. I hope you're enjoying our coverage here from Bondsforge. I know we've got viewers in America. They'll be taking notice of this.
They certainly will. We've seen already Jazz Carlin become fastest woman in the world. Dan Fogg closing on the top five swimmer performances of the world. So they'll be taking note. They're having their trials as we speak. So it'll be interesting to compare how we're doing against one of the best, or the best nation, swimming nation in the world.
Right, we're out and ready for the 200 butterfly final. Libby Mitchell in one. In fact, let's get that starting lineup on the screen for you. You can tweet us on hashtag BGSC13. There is the 1-8 for the 200 butterfly. Gemma Lowe is the red hot favourite in lane four. Eleanor Sheridan did a personal best in the semi final of 2:10.39, as did Sophie Allen in lane three. So, no, they're in pretty good form. Now, the qualifying time is well within the compass of Gemma Lowe. She's already done the time this year. She did it here yesterday in the semi final. 2:08.79 she did yesterday, 2:09.16. is the world qualifying time, and well, that is an easy one for Gemma. Now the question is, can she put anybody else along? Because with the time that Eleanor Sheridan has done now, with a 2:10.39, well, maybe a second's a bit too much to ask, but maybe in the final she'd be carried along by Gemma. Maybe she could do it too.
You've also got Sophie Allen that's about a second out. Tilly Gray is about a second out. So there's four girls here that can actually go under the qualification time for the world championship. Just looking at Gemma Lowe's PB of 2:05.36. If she did that time or faster here in Sheffield, she would also be ranked top swimmer in the world going into world championships.
Joseph Coleman watching us in Belgium. Good afternoon to you. Another one to add to our multilingual and multicultural afternoon here at Bondsforge. Wherever you are, let us know, because we'd like to know where you're watching us around the world. Watching us in Europe and watching Gemma Lowe at the 100 stage, leading the 200 butterfly in 1:01.79. Second place to Sophie Allen, not too far behind, a couple of tenths of a second behind, and Eleanor Sheridan in third. So maybe it is Sophie Allen that Gemma Lowe can pull through for a good time here.
Yeah, Gemma Lowe's not having it all her own way. We expected her to go out fast, but at the minute, Sophie Allen is right on her shoulder. She's coming up probably to take the lead with only one length to go.
This is a superb swim by Sophie Allen, and Gemma Lowe is well aware she's right on her shoulder with 50 to go. It is Sophie Allen who leads by a couple of tenths of a second from Gemma Lowe. This would be a big upset if that was the case, and Tilly Gray's now moved into third place.
Yeah, Tilly Gray's been there or thereabouts for many years. Looks like she's actually going to be pushed out into third position, as we see Gemma Lowe extending her lead with 20 metres to go, but Sophie Allen's not letting her lead her. She's on her shoulder as we go into the last 15 metres.
What a scrap this is turning out to be. Gemma Lowe, I think, has got it. She's about a body length, maybe half a body length clear of Sophie Allen. Gemma Lowe getting to the wall, just about ahead of Sophie Allen. 2:09.25 for Gemma Lowe. That is outside the qualifying time for the 200 butterfly. What happened there? Sophie Allen, 2:09.57. That's a new personal best by quite some way. And third place going to Eleanor Sheridan, 2:10.52, just outside her personal best. Now Gemma Lowe, a lot of thinking to do about that swim.
To be honest with you, she didn't look great all the way through. She looked very low in the water. She looked very tired and sluggish. And normally, well, we've seen Gemma Lowe swim a good four, nearly 5 seconds quicker than that. So maybe she's probably a little bit ill. Who knows? The year after the Olympics, probably training's not gone quite as well as she wanted to. But excellent swim from Sophie Allen. The PB for her just outside the qualification time for the World Championships.
There's a dilemma for you, because Gemma Lowe is one of our big hitters. Do you change the rules to allow her on the team? Because we won't have anybody in the 200 fly otherwise.
I think with the new regime and the new guys in charge, I don't think they'll be changing the rules. They've got a strict policy. If they're only taking 30 swimmers to the World Championship, there's going to be swimmers that, there's going to be plenty of swimmers that have done the qualification time. Gemma's not going to be in that category, so I don't think they'll take her unless she qualifies for the 100 fly.
209.25, as you see, not good enough. Sophie Allen, 209.57. Tilly Gray in third place. Eleanor Sheridan in fourth. So Gemma Lowe will now have to sit and wait and see whether she gets an inclusion. It looks unlikely to me. We are going to hear from Gemma. It'll be interesting to hear what she has to say, because, as we heard, 209.25 is 9/100ths outside the time she needs. And here she is with Cassie Patton.
So standing me or next to me on poolside here is Gemma Lowe, our British Gas Championship gold medalist for the 200 metres butterfly. Probably wasn't the time you wanted, but what else are you going to be swimming this week?
I was a little bit disappointed with that, but I've got the 100 metres tomorrow, so just got to forget about what happened tonight and look forward to that.
Definitely get some good food, some good rest, and then tomorrow is a new day. So what are you going to be doing? Are you just going to go home and having a good rest?
Yeah, obviously going to recover now and then get some good food and sleep and then get back on poolside for tomorrow.
Definitely. Well, we're going to be wishing you the best of luck for the 100 metres tomorrow. That's a massive round of applause for our gold medalist, Gemma Lowe.
Well done to Gemma Lowe. You can see she was maybe disappointed with that. And actually, I think in the semi-final, she did do the qualification time. But as the policy says, they do have to do the time in the final. So it's going to be a tough few days for her to see if she can maybe back it up in the 100 metres. We've got a final coming up very soon for you. But we did also have a chance to meet Ben Proud's coach. We've already heard from Ben Proud today. And we also spoke to John Rudd. Now, John Rudd is very well known in the field of coaching. He's a highly qualified coach when it comes to age and youth, and he spoke about how important it is to have a really rounded program for our athletes. And I'm sure all the athletes that are swimming here today would agree that they need to have their schooling in place or their lifestyle in place, and that's exactly what John said. And it's really exciting to see some youngsters coming up and really improving, like Ben Proud. Just seen Elena Sheridan there doing a great job, one of the youngsters coming through. And John actually has a swimmer in the next race. We have Joe Patching, who will look forward to see how the Plymouth Leander swimmer gets on. But before we head over to that final, we have a couple of your tweets coming in. Lots of support for Jazz Carling. Swindon Dolphins and St. Felix Club have all said well done to Jazz Carling for breaking that huge PB and a British record. So she should be really pleased with that swim. You can continue to tweet us at BGSC13 and we will do our best to read out your tweets. But without further ado, we're going to head back to Bob for the men's 100 metres backstroke. Over to you, Bob.
And after the big build-up, we have a withdrawal in lane two. Joe Patching's not due yet. He's not there. So we've given him the big build-up, and Joe's let us down big time here, Ross, hasn't he? There is a spare lane in lane two, unless he's going to arrive late, but he's not going to. So we have one, we have three, four, five, six, seven, and eight, but we do not have a number two, which is probably appropriate at this stage. 100 backstroke for men. Now, I will be interested to see whether Chris Walker-Hebben can back up his personal best of last night, a time that puts him fourth in the world, 53.41. Now, he's in four, Liam Tancock's in six. Now, Liam Tancock is the British record holder, 52.73. How is this race going to pan out? I am intrigued to see, A, how Liam Tancock swims it, and B, how Chris Walker-Hebben swims it. Can he do two swims of that quality in 24 hours?
We've seen Liam go through the rounds very, very relaxed and very easy, not showing his full cards. We've seen Chris Walker-Hebben lay down a marker yesterday. At the time, Liam probably did a roundabout at the Olympic Games last year, so this is going to be a very, very exciting race to see. As we're heading down to the first 50 metres, it is Chris Walker-Hebben that turns first, which is extremely surprising.
25.64 for him, 25.92 for Liam Tancock. Third place to Marco Loughran. Well, Chris Walker-Hebben could this be the big surprise, as Liam Tancock got what it takes with 25 to go. Walker-Hebben still in front here, Ross.
He is, but I know Liam's been working incredibly hard on the second 50. He normally turns first, but to be honest with you,
nobody's going to beat Chris Walker-Hedman. He's about half a metre ahead of the rest of the field.
This is very impressive, and Chris Walker-Hedman, 53.38 is his time, quicker than he went yesterday, and that keeps him fourth in the world. Liam Tancock in second, Marco Loughran in third, and the qualifying time of 53.98 is achieved by Walker-Hedman, but not achieved by Liam Tancock.
That is very, very surprising. Liam Tancock's been the poster boy of British swimming. He's been the leader of this backstroke event for so long. He's a very humble guy. He's a very nice guy. But on that occasion, Chris Walker-Hedman's got the better of him. I'll expect Liam now to go back and really train hard. This is certainly not the end of Liam Tancock by any means. This will probably really use his motivation going into the Commonwealth Games next year. He has the 50 metres that we'll be concentrating on. He is the world championship record holder. He is the world champion from the last two world championships. So expect Liam to come back meaner, leaner, and certainly faster in the 50 metres backstroke later on in the week.
Well, that time is about a third of a second slower for Walker-Hedman than the fastest time in the world from Jeremy Stravius at the moment. So that's not a million miles away outside a medal. Fourth in the world, not massively outside the Ryosuke Irie time, or indeed Kosuke Higino in the top four, and he's improved upon it tonight. Here is Chris Walker-Hedman, and he is speaking with Cassie Patton.
Just getting his breath back next to me is Chris Walker-Hedman, the gold medalist of the men's 100 metres backstroke. Underneath that qualifying time for the World Championships in Barcelona, how are you feeling?
Absolutely buzzing. I mean, things have been going really well, and you know, the qualifying time was tough, but to come here and go that sort of time, pretty speechless, to be fair.
So you've got about 5 weeks before the championship. You're ranked fourth in the world. How are you going to be training and getting ready for Barcelona?
Well, we go back next week, back into another hard week, and just kind of plod on through before we start coming back down again, and hopefully do the same again in Barcelona.
Let's have a massive round of applause for Chris Walker-Hedman, our gold medalist.
Well done, Chris Walker-Hedman. He's probably one of the first success stories from the Bath ITC camp this week. They've got a great setup there, I can say that, because I'm from Bath, so I can agree under the coach of Dave McNulty. And it's great to see him really bouncing back off the back of 2012. So we're back here, and we're going to be talking about the medal presentations for the 800 freestyle. And let's talk about those girls. The Twitter has been going wild for Jazz Carling and Ellie Faulkner. What do you think of those girls' swims?
Absolutely incredible. To do a time that's the fastest in the world is, you know, it's no mean feat. And to do it here with a British crowd behind her, with the year that she had last year, it's only going to serve her well going into the World Championships. We just saw a major shock there in the 100 metres backstroke. Liam Tancock's been the British record holder for many, many years, being beaten by Chris Walker-Hedman. Liam will use that as motivation going now into the next year in the Commonwealth Games. But you can see there the girls receiving their medals. Incredible swim from Jazz.
And I think Ellie also with a massive PB and doing the qualification time. So she's also got the 200 free coming up, and Jazz has got the 400 free coming up. So they've got a busy night ahead of them. They probably don't want to be hanging around on that medal podium for too long.
No, they certainly won't do, but I don't think, you know, I think Jazz is going to enjoy this moment after the disappointment from last year. You know, she could go and walk up a mountain right now the way she's going to be feeling. So 200 metres freestyle is going to be nothing to her. So, you know, the thing is with Jazz, she's such a lovely girl. She's one of the sweetest girls that I know. And last year would have really hit her hard. And, you know, sometimes people don't deserve the look that they get. But on this occasion, she's used that as a motivator, and she's come back really, really strong this year.
And let's just discuss Gemma Lowe's swim in the 200 metres fly. I mean, she must be really disappointed with that. Like, she's always had a lot of expectation on her shoulders, always expected a lot of her. What do you think went wrong?
Well, yeah, she even said in an interview that she was disappointed with the time and she was hoping to go a lot quicker. She's outside the qualification time for the World Championship, so she won't be considered on that event. She does have the 100 metres fly coming up later on in the week. But you can see here, for Gemma, she's always really, really high in the water, and here she's looking very, very low. Sophie Allen was right on her shoulder for 95% of the race. We know Gemma Lowe can go quicker. She has been quicker. She's been 4 seconds quicker. She made the Olympic final last year in the 200 metres fly. So this is not Gemma Lowe on her best form. And again, similar to Liam Tancock, she can really move on after this disappointment.
Do you think she's tightened up? I mean, she did the time this morning yesterday in the semi-final. Is it just tensing up in that fly stroke?
You sometimes get it in a butterfly. If you do tense up, you go a lot slower. Swimmers will stand behind the blocks, and if they are physically tight and they're really nervous and they try too hard, and that's something that probably Gemma Lowe did. She's done the qualification time last night, so you know it's probably not a form thing. It's probably she just got a little bit too excited, a bit nervous, and she wanted to get that qualification time.
And as you can see there, we have the medal ceremony for the men's 800 metres. Freestyle, and that was quite an exciting race because it wasn't the standard layout. The fastest swimmer was in the outside lane, Daniel Fogg, so it was maybe not as expected that person was going to be winning for the crowd.
The way that they rank the 800 metres, because we don't do it in Britain that much, it's only at the World Championships that it's in terms of internationally recognised. So what we did here to rank the swimmers, they took them off the 400 PB from last year, and Dan Fogg had one of the slowest 400 times, but certainly we saw last night he's now got one of the fastest 400 time, and he was placed in the outside lane. But it was great to see him and Jack Bennell, training partners at Loughborough University, coached by Kev Renshaw, and the assistant coach is Graham Smith, who won a bronze medal at the 96 Atlanta Olympic Games in the 1500. So there's a wealth of experience behind these guys, and they went 1 and 2 all the way to the end.
Brilliant. Well, we look forward to see how he gets on in those next few races and in the open water. But we've got coming up for you now a few more finals. We have the 200 metres backstroke. We have the 100 metres breaststroke. 200 metres fly. You've got the 400 IM. Look out for Hannah Miley in that as she'll be going for a fast time. 200 metres breaststroke. There's always a fierce competition between those lads. As you can see, lots to look forward to with the multi-classification races as well. But for now, we are going to head back to the final of the women's 200 metres backstroke, and let's see how Lizzie Simmons gets on in the final.
200 back then, containing the likes of Lauren Quigley and Lizzie Simmons. Our Olympic finalists from last year got so close to a medal, just edged out of the bronze. Was Lizzie Simmons, and she is in lane number 4. Let's give you the full run through of 1-8. Natasha Houghton of Nova Centurion goes in 1. To Charlotte McKenzie of Falkirk, and in fact, here is the full list for you. Natasha Houghton in 1, Charlotte McKenzie in 2, Rachel Lefley in 3. And then Lizzie Simmons, Jessica Fuller-Love, Lauren Quigley, all swimming pretty well. Lizzie Simmons, though, should be the red-hot favourite. She is the British record. She's the English record holder. No, she's not. Gemma Spofforth is. But Lizzie, 206.79, very close to that British record held by Gemma. Yeah, forgotten, of course, going back to the days of the suits. Gemma, 206.66 was the time that gave her that very impressive swim. She was the 100 gold medalist from Rome, but here we are in the 200 territory. No Gemma now, of course, she has retired, but Lizzie carries on, and she is only 22 years of age. She seems to have been around for a very, very long time, does Lizzie Simmons. She emerged at the age of 13, 14, still going strong, moved from Loughborough to Bath ITC in the summer, and as you would expect, she is setting the pace early on in this 200 backstroke.
We always see Lizzie swimming fast all year round, but this year she's moved down to Bath to be coached by Dave McNulty. Dave's got a different approach on things. He likes the swimmers to put in the long, hard yards, and that makes you slower all through the season. So she's not been swimming as quick as she would like to in mid-season, but here, this is where it really matters, at the trials and then going on to the World Championships.
Well, she leads at 50 and leads by about a quarter of a second from Jessica Fuller-Love in second, and Lauren Quigley in third place. Fourth is Rachel Lefley. Expect Quigley to start to make her move in lane number 6 fairly soon. She's just playing possum a little bit, although she's coming on terms with Lizzie Simmons as they come into the 100, and it's Jessica Fuller-Love who's in that sandwich in lane number 5, but it will be Simmons probably from Quigley at the turn. Let's see how big the gap is now between 1 and 2. It is still about half a second between Simmons and Quigley, so she hasn't broken Quigley yet. And but this is where Lizzie always gets stronger. She prefers the 200 to the 100, and this is where she starts to really turn on the gas.
It is, but Jessica Fuller-Love in the lane just above her is coming through really strong on this third 50. The 200 metres, the third 50 is the most important. That sets you up for the last 50. Lizzie using around about 13, 14 metres of the underwater phase. Let's see what she does when she comes off this final turn.
2:09.71 is the qualifying time for the World Championships. It's the time that Lizzie Simmons, I knew I would do it sometime today. Lizzie Simmons has done a 2:06.79 before now, but has she got what it takes here, or she'll be overhauled by either Jessica Fuller-Love or Lauren Quigley? It is all about Lizzie, but has she got the momentum to take it to that time, Ross?
Looks like lane six, Lauren Quigley's coming through very, very fastly. It's going to be right on the touch between Lizzie Simmons and Lauren Quigley. It looks like Lizzie's going to get it.
Well, is she going to get that time? No, is the answer. 2:10.08 means that she is 0.3 seconds outside the qualifying time for the World Championship. Lauren Quigley, 2:10.15. That is a new personal best by almost a second for Lauren Quigley. And third place going to Jessica Fuller-Love in 2:10.59. In fact, that's exactly a minute personal best. So second and third will be delighted with their performances. I don't think that Lizzie Simmons will be.
Now you can see now she doesn't look too happy with that. That really hurt her. That's not what she was looking for at all. She's going to have to now regroup and focus on the 100 metres because 200 is her main event, but she won't be going to the World Championships on that. So she needs to qualify now on the 100 metres backstroke if she wants to go to Barcelona.
That's a little worry for me that two of our big hitters have not made the team tonight. Gemma Lowe and Lizzie Simmons have not done the times that take them through to Barcelona.
And Liam Tancock, of course, but Liam, you'd expect to qualify on the 50 metres backstroke. And once these guys qualify, if they do qualify in another event, maybe if there's a spare spot, they will be able to enter the other event. But at the minute, the World Championships are only 4 weeks away. What difference are they going to be from now until then? They might not be on form.
Lizzie Simmons, 2:10.08. She's won it, though. Lauren Quigley in second. New personal best, big one for her. And 2:10.59 for Jessica Fuller-Love. Just checking on Rachel Leffley, see what she's done at personal best. Now, that's a bit slow by her standards as well. So, Lizzie, really not in the kind of shape you would have hoped for. I was looking down the top five in the world, thinking maybe she'd get in the 2:08 range. 2:06.79 is her best time. But, of course, that's when she had the suits. Don't know quite how much difference that made in suit time. Her season's best before today was 2:10.25. So she has gone a little bit quicker than that, but not sufficiently quick enough to make that team. Just checking through the Scots to see if anybody's done. Daniel Stirrup, for example, 2:15.85, and not challenging Georgia Davis's Welsh record. Right, I'm sure she'll have some things to say about that swim. Here is Lizzie Simmons now with Cassie Patton.
So, Elizabeth Simmons, agonisingly close then, but you've got the 100 coming up. Tell us, how are you feeling for that?
Yeah, definitely. You know, races don't always go your way, and it's been a very up and down year. Obviously, amazing year last year at Olympics, and you know, obviously it's been a little bit tough this year transitioning to a new program. But I definitely believe that I can massively take it forward from that. I guess you learn a lot from every race you do, good and bad. So, look towards the 100 later this week, and hopefully move it forward.
Definitely, that's one of the strengths of a swimmer of your calibre, be able to bounce back from disappointment. So I definitely wish you all the best in the 100 later on this week. Let's have a massive round of applause for Elizabeth Simmons.
So Lizzie would be very disappointed with that swim. But we saw last year that we didn't have the greatest Olympic Games, but the year before we had a fantastic World Championships, a fantastic Commonwealth Games. The year before that we had a fantastic World Championships as well. And I think what we found out from last year, it only matters what happens at the Olympic Games. So these swimmers will be very, very disappointed, but as long as Lizzie can get it right and get her head down and get happy with where she is going into Rio, if we can get on song Lizzie Simmons in Rio, then that's only going to be great for Great Britain.
Yeah, do you know what? I came out of Yessi feeling very upbeat, and I do off the back of Jazz Cullen and Dan Fogg today, and then I just feel a little bit of kind of, a little bit deflated, because two of our big hitters, and I do consider Gemma and Lizzie to be our big hitters, have failed to deliver today.
But we've seen Lizzie and Gemma produce great performances at the European Championships, at the World Championships, and Lizzie's from really, well, both of those girls from really well at the Olympic Games, but they didn't medal. But the medaling at the other competitions, we need to change that around. We need to almost, if you could choose not to medal at the World Championships and medal at Olympic Games, that's what we need them to do. So this is, like Lizzie said, a transitional year for her. She's moved programme, And I think if we can get her fit and ready to go in Rio, it'd be great.
On to the next final of the evening. Now, I am hopeful, and I don't want to put the mockers on any of the people here, but I think that Siobhan Marie O'Connor might be happy with a crack at this. Sophie Allen will, Stacey Tad will. Georgina Evans, who's been the big revelation in this event for us this week, has done two personal bests. Both in the heat and the semi-final, it's going to be putting pressure on Sophie Allen, and I imagine lane two as well, Siobhan Marie O'Connor won't be too far away.
Yeah, we saw George Evans having a poor finish last night. If she'd had nailed her finish, she would have been going into this race in lane four as the fastest qualifier. But Georgia Evans, Sophie Allen, Stacey Tad, and Siobhan Marie O'Connor, 5, 4, 3, and 2 lanes where we expect the race to be.
And I should mention, the number one ranked swimmer in the world trains in this country, at Plymouth. That's Ruta Miliatiti of Lithuania.
If only she was British.
Yes, if only. I have talked to John Rudd about that several times, but nope, she's an absolute star and revered in Lithuania. It is not going to happen, sadly, in terms of a conversion to being a Brit, so we'll have to make do with what we got. We've got a fair depth of talent in this event now, too. Stacey Tad in 3, Siobhan Marie O'Connor 2, Sophie Allen 4, Georgina Evans in 5, Sophie Taylor 6. It's pretty much a wide open race, this.
Certainly is. See Siobhan Marie O'Connor have a fantastic start. She's leading the first 25 metres, but it looks like the rest of the field have caught up with her. And it is Catherine Johnston in lane 7, the 50 specialist that represented Scotland in Delhi for the 50 metres breaststroke, that is actually going to turn first.
Now, she did this yesterday and then fell away over the next 50. I don't expect her to be in the mix at the end, to be absolutely honest. Stacey Tad is second, and Georgina Evans at the moment is finding the speed of this, the pace of this, maybe the occasion for this a bit too much, but she is starting to come back now. That wasn't a great split at 50, but she's coming back in 5, but it is Sophie Allen in 4, or could it be Stacey Tad in 3? It's going to be Sophie Allen who's going to take this for the University of Bath. She's going to hold off her teammate to her left-hand side, and it is Sophie Allen who gets it in 107.70. She has got the qualifying time. Stacey Tad missing out in 108.11, and Sophie Taylor in 3rd. Georgina Evans, sadly, was not able to back up a swim from last night. She went a little bit slow, but Sophie Allen of the University of Bath has improved on her qualifying time and her semi-final time and has done 107.70, and that is not too far outside the British record held by Kate Hayward.
That's a fantastic swim from Sophie Allen. We've seen her already tonight in the women's 200 metres butterfly, and now she's absolutely flying on the 100 metres breaststroke. We can see there she went into the turn probably about sixth position at 50 metres. She stormed her way through that last 50 metres, touched the wall in 107.7 under the qualification time for the World Championships, and that's looking fantastic, not only for herself, but for the medley relay as well.
Yeah, impressive stuff. And I'll say that English record, 107.56, not too far away. Kate Hayward holds it, continues to hold it, but Sophie Allen closing in on it, 107.70. What did Catherine Johnston do? 108.90, just outside her Scottish record in the 100 metres breaststroke. Sophie Allen finishing in 3rd place. Stacey Tad just outside the qualifying time in 2nd with a time of 108.11. So let's hear what the winner, Sophie Allen, has to say about that swim with Cassie Patton.
So with me is an elated Sophie Allen. You've just gone under the qualifying time for Barcelona, straight out of a 200 fly as well. How are you feeling?
Tired. No, yeah, I was really happy with that. Haven't done loads of breaststroke training. I've been focusing on the 200 fly because that was a new event for me. So I was kind of just hoping for the best in that, so I'm buzzing.
So people know you more as a 200 and like 400 IMer. How is it just to be focusing on the breaststroke and like the fly events?
Yeah, I think it's good because it gives me a few more options, doesn't put like all the pressure on one event.
Well, you've definitely done the job, and have a massive round of applause for our gold medalist and under the qualifying time for Barcelona, Sophie Allen.
If you want to get in touch with us, hashtag is BGSC13. We'd love to hear from you. There's a lot of things to talk about tonight. Some good things, some bad things, some indifferent things, but that is a very good thing. That's given made me feel a bit more upbeat that we've got somebody closing in on that British record.
Yeah, that's right. And she was the breakthrough swimmer from last year.
came through, qualified for the 200 metres IM at the London Olympic Games, and she's followed that form through to do that 100. Like she said, she didn't even train for breaststroke. She's been training for the 200 metres butterfly and just missed out on the team for that, but came back only 10, 15 minutes later to qualify for the World Championships.
Let's have a look who is going to be involved in the final of the men's 200 metres butterfly. It's an event in which, of course, we got a bronze medal in 2004 in Athens through Steve Parry. And Roberto Pavoni is the fastest qualifier in lane four, but Joe Roebuck will be gunning for him in lane five. And Daniel Wallace, who I think is based in the States, is near the moment, is going in lane number three.
Yeah, that's right. This race is going to be in the middle. It's lane four and five. Roberto Pavoni, fastest qualifier from last night. It's closely followed by only 0.4 seconds behind by Joe Roebuck of University of Bath. Joe used to train in Loughborough University last year, but has moved down to the University of Bath. And we've seen some good things from Bath already this week. Obviously seeing Chris Walker Heaven win in the 100 metres backstroke. So things are looking great for what Dave McNulty is doing down there in Bath.
Now, I have to say, we are a little way shy of the best in the world on entry times here. There are five swimmers in around the 155.2, 155.5 situation. Roberto Pavoni's best time is 156.10, so Joe Roebuck has done a 155. Yes, he is the only swimmer in this field who has done a 155 high. So to get the qualifying time, 156.48, that is certainly within the realms of possibility for three of the swimmers here. Pavoni, Roebuck and Wallace all have done times in and around that or better. So this could be a good scrap. I think it's going to be a scrap between four and five, but you never know what Dan Wallace has been up to out of sight, out of mind. A couple of interesting Sheffield strips here. Orange. Never normally associate Sheffield, but that's Matt Johnson going for the orange shorts, and he's been matched by Roberto Pavoni as well going with that. I'm not sure the orange goes with the blue cap, but you never know. I'm not a fashion expert on these things. I know you are, Ross. You can tell me whether that's good or bad or indifferent.
Well, swimmers are not normally known for their fashion, but obviously being a stylistic myself, I would not have put those two colours together. But we can see Joe Roebuck leading this race out. He normally just go out quite quickly, but Roberto Pavoni is closely behind. He's only 0.05 seconds behind at that first turn.
Dan Wallace and Roberto Pavoni absolutely locked together in time on the first 50. I did say watch out for Dan Wallace because he has been doing some good times and some good training. And that may have given Joe Roebuck a bit of a come on there because he was a little bit shy of where he should be. Roberto Pavoni now has been usurped by Roebuck on that 50. And Roebuck it is now, goes into the wall in place number one. Pavoni is second. Matt Johnson third. This race is changing with virtually every 50. Well, it has done so far because now Joe Roebuck's taking up the cudgels. And how will Roberto Pavoni react?
Roberto Pavoni trains in Loughborough, trains with Dan Fogg and Jack Rennell, so the 10K specialist, so expect him to come back extremely quick. Joe Roebuck down in the University of Bath, he's gone out quick and he is leading at the minute. He's probably about half a metre ahead going into the final turn.
156.48 is the qualifying time for Barcelona, and it looks like we're going to get Matt Johnson coming through into second place, out of sight, out of mind in lane number two. Johnson really is going for this big time. Now Roebuck probably is going to take this, but Matt Johnson is coming with a storming swim. Pavoni has left it way too late to overcome Joe Roebuck, and Matt Johnson probably went a little bit too quick there and is paying for it now. It is going to be Joe Roebuck, 156.468 is the time, 156.49. He's missed out by 1/100th of a second for the qualifying time. That is ridiculous. You couldn't even plan that. 156.49, but Pavoni got second in the end. Johnson 157.92. That's a massive new PB for Matt Johnson finishing in third place. But once again, this is turning out to be one of those nights, isn't it? Joe Roebuck needed 156.48. He did 156.49 and has not made the time.
You can see he's incredibly disappointed. Coming into the third turn now, Matt Johnson was right up there with Roberto Pavoni and Joe Roebuck. Joe Roebuck really did lay the hammer down on that fourth 50, but he's just 1/100th away from that qualification time.
And great swim from Matthew Johnson in lane two, coming third, 157.92. But I was surprised with Pav, actually. I thought he'd be a lot quicker. He went a little bit quicker in the, just a little bit slower in the semi-final. I expected him to be in the 156s, and it wasn't to be tonight.
Well, we've got to give even-handed coverage here. That's one event in which the men have failed us, unfortunately. 156.49 for Roebuck, 157.34 for Pavoni. But Matt Johnson going into the European Juniors next week, we'll be delighted with that, because his season's best before today was 2 minutes dead. 157.92. He's never been below 158 before. And Dan Wallace fading a little bit at the end, 159.95 in fourth place. That is half a second slower than he went in the semi-finals. Well, again, we're just getting our breaths back, because we all assumed that Joe Roebuck, who's done a 155.9 before now, would be there or thereabouts. But not the case, unfortunately. He misses out. And there may be a few little decisions to be made for the new National Performance Director, Bill Furness. Just some swimmers peppering the qualification time, but Joe Roebuck very unhappy. He's not going to talk to us, so I could just clarify. Joe Roebuck 156.49, Pavoni in second 157.34, and Matt Johnson 157.92. Well, there's the crowd. That man's enjoying himself, isn't he, on the left? Obviously didn't realize he was on camera, but there's been some really good stuff and some not so good stuff in this session so far. Had three times not achieved, two for the women, one for the men, and we've seen an absolute storming swim by Jazz Carlin in the 800 freestyle, of course, number one in the world. Let's go back to Kate Gray in the studio.
My goodness, what an exciting package of finals we had there. Some qualifying, some just missing out. I do not want to be one of those swimmers right now when you realise how much heartbreak is involved with missing a time by 1/100th of a second. Now, we have a number of medal ceremonies coming up, but let's review some of the last finals that we've had. We had the 200 metres backstroke Ross with the likes of Lizzie Simmons, again, missing out her time. Probably absolutely gutted about that, because, you know, she was a favourite to be on the team.
She certainly was. She's been around the team for the last 8 years, and she was earmarked to be on that team, and she's not going to be qualifying for the 200 metres backstroke in Barcelona. She does have another chance on the 100 metres. She was a clear winner. It was very close towards the end, just dying off towards the end. But she's in a transitional year, and I think it'll take her a while to settle down at the University of Bath, and hopefully we can see her back to her best.
Well, from one University of Bath member to the next, Sophie Allen had a cracking swim in that breaststroke. Both her and Lizzie have both moved to the University of Bath, and maybe one's transitioned slightly better than the other, but we weren't expecting Sophie to be the one from Bath to be taking this particular gold medal.
No, we didn't. We can see there she turned pretty much in last position in the 50 metres ago. It was all talk was about Sharon Marie O'Connor. It was actually Sophie Allen that came through to get the qualification time, and only under two-tenths off the British record, Kate Hayward's British record from a few years ago.
And then also we have the Joe Roebuck butterfly there. He clearly wasn't happy because he didn't have that interview. Obviously completely gutted. No one would want to be losing out by 1/100th of a second.
No, he's a clear winner there, and just missing the qualification time. You can see there he's not happy. He's not a happy bunny. Missing the qualification time by 1/100. That's incredibly tough. You swim four lengths of this pool, and to come down to 1/100, that's disappointing.
And yeah, well, those reviews really do just show how close it really is to make this qualification time. But at the moment, we have the presentation for the women's 200 metres butterfly. So, 200 metres backstroke. And at the top there, we see Chris Walker Habon, or with Leon Tancock there receiving the silver medal. But let's focus on Chris, because he did a great swim there. He really did seem to get stuck in, take on the baton in front of him, and take that gold medal.
We've seen Chris many times show a lot of potential, but then when it really matters, probably not show it. Today, the pressure was on him. He did a fantastic time yesterday. He's in the top five world rankings now, and he backed that up with a faster time in the final. And that's what we want the British swimmers to do. They want to produce great times in this heat, semi-finals and finals, and then when they go to the major competitions, repeat that as well. Liam Tancott's not going to be used to standing on the second position spot, so I would expect to see a very angry and determination Liam Tancock towards the end of this week and moving forward in the next 3 years.
guys talk a bit about momentum? Because athletes do really run off the back of this momentum. We've seen a couple of Bath athletes do well, same within the other clubs. How much does the momentum of a successful team have an impact on their performance?
Yeah, like you see, you know, if you're in a training squad of 8 to 10 people and you know that 3 or 4 of you are swimming well, that can only mean good things, that you're doing the right things and you're going to swim well. And you've seen that in Loughborough and you've seen that in Bath as well.
Brilliant. Well, we've got a great final coming up for you in just a moment. We want to say keep tweeting us at BGSC13. We've got loads of you giving us all your information. We've got someone from Toronto who's actually been tweeting us saying that he's really enjoying the coverage and lots of support for the great performances that we've got coming up and that we've already experienced as well. One being Hannah Miley. She's coming up, Smiley Miley we like to call her, in the 400 metres individual medley. She's got a big battle on her hands because Amy Wilmot did a great swim this morning to really compete for that first place, but both of them are going to be going for the qualification time. I know Amy Wilmot actually pulled out of an event yesterday to ensure she was in the best possible shape ready for this final tonight. So let's get ready to hand over to Bob Ballard, who will be running us through the order of the 400 metres individual medley.
And we only have 6 going to start here. We did only have 8 this morning in the heats. Well, 2 have pulled out, so we've got a final with 6. And as you heard mentioned by Kate, Amy Wilmot in lane 4, just marginally by a tenth of a second quicker than Hannah Miley in the heats. 400 metres individual medley. That's why we'll go through all the names. Zara Bailey of City of Peterborough did her best time in qualifying this morning. Danielle Lowe, likewise, actually just outside of personal best in lane 3. Amy Wilmot, one of our Olympians in the 400 IM. Anna Miley, who just missed out on a medal in London back last summer, goes in 5 for Geary. Ellis Jackson, St. Felix School in lane number 6. Personal best for her in the heats this morning. And Rachel Solway, who has been 4:46.91, but was about 8 seconds shy of that. But of course, not everybody was busting a gut this morning. They didn't have to because there were only 8, and only 8 could qualify, of course. We're down to 6. The main protagonists are still in there, Amy Wilmot and Hannah Miley. Now, as we know with Hannah, or we've seen with Hannah, the best part of a race always comes in the second half. Her second half is immensely strong, so don't be too concerned if Amy Wilmot has a bit of a lead when it comes to 100 or 200, because that is where Hannah Miley's race starts to kick in.
Certainly is, and that's the strongest part of any IM swimmer. If they're good at the breaststrokes section of the race, whether it's a 200 or a 400, they tend to be a great IM swimmer. But at the minute, I think we can see Danielle Lowe leading out the fly leg by a good second over the rest of the field.
Interesting to see that Hannah is now doing the fly, because when her breaststroke wasn't particularly good, she started to do the breaststroke to make it better. Now she's doing the individual fly to make her fly better, because she knows the front part of the race is where she has to play catch-up, and sometimes at world level and Olympic level, it's difficult to do that.
We see it very often really close down on the field and certainly world and Olympic level on that breaststroke leg, but sometimes she's just left herself a little bit too much to do. So now she's focused on the front end of the race, because if she can be with those girls going into the 200 metre mark, going into that breaststroke leg, she can then actually move ahead of the field, and she's extremely strong on the freestyle, and then hopefully she can keep that on, and instead of trying to win bronze and silver medals, she can go and hopefully win gold medals.
Second at that turn, it'll be halfway stage, of course, when they finish this backstroke leg. But Danielle Lowe is still in front, but she'll need a big advantage here coming in with 200 to go, because we know that Hannah Miley will eat into that time. Amy Wilmot has a very good freestyle at the end, so she'll be there or thereabouts. But it is good to see Danielle Lowe. Best time for her is the time she set this morning, just outside, 4:46.43. She did 4:46.58. So we know she's on personal best time. But this now, when they get on to the breaststroke leg and then the freestyle leg, you can see Hannah Miley already in that 15 to 20 metres has come alongside Danielle Lowe and now overtaking her.
Yeah, it's taken Hannah Miley 10 strokes to get on alongside Danielle Lowe, but she's really taken this race to do the girls, and this could be an upset whether Danielle can hold on to the second position or not. But at the minute, Hannah Miley's leading and Amy Wilmot is coming through like a train.
Breaststroke leg 50 completed, another 50 to come for Hannah Miley, who has now opened up an advantage of about half a second over Danielle Lowe. And we know how strong her front crawl leg is, and Amy Wilmot's given herself a little bit to do here to overhaul Danielle Lowe. She's relying a lot on probably her strongest stroke, which is at the back end, but that qualifying time is well within the compass of Hannah Miley, Amy Wilmot, and not quite Danielle Lowe, I don't think. 4:40.75, we'll have to see, but this is all now about Hannah Miley against the clock and whether she can pull Amy Wilmot along to that qualifying time.
If Amy Wilmot goes anywhere near her best, she'll be under the world qualification time and should have dragged along Danielle Lowe because she's right with her at the minute. But there's no doubt who's winning this final of the 400 individual medley. It is Hannah Miley, around about 4 metres ahead of the rest of the field with only 75 metres to go.
Of course, I should mention that Hannah has the fastest time in the world this year, 4:34.21. Shi Wenye of China second, but Hannah did a 4:34.21 earlier this year. Now, can she get anywhere close? She's really going for it now. This is where she opens up with 50 to go. Let's have a look and see what the split time is for her. 4:03.75. Can she do? She's certainly going to do. She's surely going to do, isn't she? A time that's inside 4:34.
Probably not. She's probably going to go around about 4:37. She's going to be under the qualification time for the World Championships. And it looks like the other girls are just going to be outside of that.
Well, let's see what time Hannah can do. 4:34.21. She's already got that marker down, but 4:40.75. She needs to be inside that. She will be sufficiently inside that. And her finishing time is 4:35.67. So she's 5 seconds inside. And Amy Wilmot has done it too. 4:38.95. Second place for Amy Wilmot. That is a qualifying time. So we have both of our British swimmers. And she says, good job. You heard Hannah say, good job to Amy Wilmot there. They are good teammates from the Olympics last year. And they'll be teammates again in Barcelona. Hannah Miley smashes it as she always does in the 400. And Amy Wilmot in second place with the qualifying time too.
Yeah, those two girls smashing that qualification time for Barcelona. Danielle Lowe had a fantastic race. She did a PB to qualify for, or just outside a PB to qualify for that final, but she's just improved that by 4 seconds. So she's certainly a swimmer to look out for in the future. She looks a little, well, I can't work out if she looks disappointed or over the moon with her time, but she's certainly put a great swim in there to come third.
I'd be very happy with her at Bevington Club. That's a massive PB for her. At this point, before we hear from Hannah, as we will do shortly, I'll say hello to those at Woking Swim Club who are enjoying our coverage. Thank you very much indeed for your tweet direct to me. Remember, if you want to get involved in the programme, it is hashtag BGSC13. Wherever you are, Toronto, US, Australia, Belgium, we're always happy to hear from you via Twitter. And we're here for a considerable time, yeah, another hour or so. So we would love to hear from you about what you've enjoyed about today, about the swimmers you've enjoyed watching, and perhaps a few words of encouragement for those who've just missed out on the time they need for Barcelona. We will be hearing from Hannah Miley very, very soon indeed, after that 4:35.67. Very comfortable qualification, second. In fact, that is just working out. Yeah, it's about the sixth fastest time in the world to go with her first fastest time in the world. So Hannah Miley in very, very good shape going into Barcelona in a few weeks' time. And, of course, she has taken Amy Wilmot with her onto that World Championship team. Let's see what Hannah Miley has to say about another good swim at Ponds.
Joining me on poolside is the aptly named Smiley Miley. It is Hannah Miley. Now, you've definitely got something to smile about. You've gone under the qualifying time for Barcelona, the World Championships, and you're ranked number one in the world. How are you feeling going into that?
I'm actually only ranked number one in the world by like 0.06 of a second. So, yeah, there's going to be a lot of competition, but now that I definitely know that I can go for the 400 medley, it's going to be quite an exciting race. And at the moment, the Americans are kind of doing their trials, so it'll be interesting to see how they go in their finals. I watched them do their heats, so they've seen obviously what I've done, and hopefully they'll it's their turn because they're the last ones to race.
Wonderful. Well, I know you've got your 200 freestyle semi-final in a minute, so I'm going to let you dash off. But let's have a massive round of applause for our gold medalist, Hannah Miley.
Yeah, as always, we say that she's rarely out of the pool. She'd do the men's events if she could. 4:35.67 for Hannah. Amy, 4:38.95. We have a DQ there for one of the swimmers. Ellis Jackson is DQ'd, so her time will not count. But Danielle Lowe in third place with a new personal best and a big one, too, 4:42.60. On to the semi-finals. Now, of course, this was the best event for Britain. That's the London 2012 Games, in the pool that is, of course, because we're about to see very shortly an Olympic silver medalist. But he comes up in semi-final number one. We'll see an Olympic finalist as well in the second semi. So you think on paper this is probably the weaker of the two semi-finals. And here are the 1-8 in the men's 200 breaststroke semi-final number one. Craig Benson, though, did a personal best this morning to qualify second fastest. Adam Peaty's had a great week for City of Derby. And Tristan Slater, a bit of a mystery to us from Millfield, did a big PB in the heats this morning.
It's almost like the second semi-final is the experience, and this is the youth and the new guys coming through. So it should be interesting to see how these guys get on and what kind of marker they put down for the more experienced swimmers in the second semi-final.
That's Andrew Rodgy you saw from Edinburgh University. The British record, of course, is held by Michael Jameson, 207.43. Won't get anywhere near that, I don't think, in this semi-final. But interesting to see what Craig Benson can do, improving on that personal best he set this morning, 2:13.37. We associate him more with the 100 than the 200. All of a sudden, he is really stepping up and trying to put pressure on his Scottish teammate Michael Jameson. And say Tristan Slater this morning, 2:15.80, never been that quick before. Rob Holden is not quite on form. If he was, he'd be doing a 2:11. At the moment, he's about 4 or 5 seconds outside of that.
I think a lot of these swimmers this morning were just trying to make the semi-final, reserve as much energy as possible so they can really hit this semi-final hard and hopefully make the final tomorrow night. We've seen Adam Peaty already getting a silver medal in the 50 metres breaststroke. He's not normally a 200 metres breaststroker, but he's actually qualified fourth fastest for tonight, or fifth fastest for tonight's semi-final, and he's at the minute is leading this out.
I mentioned Rob Holderness, 2:11.85 is his personal best, and he was a long way outside that swan, but he was leading at 50 there, with Adam Peaty in second and Craig Benson in third. It will all change around. Maybe it won't, because Rob Holderness is taking this out massively, strongly, in lane number two. He's going with a purpose here, and where he's going for 100 time here, just to give himself a bit of confidence, or whether he can hold on to this. It's a very interesting split, 1:02.95 for him. Adam Peaty in second. Craig Benson, after that personal best this morning, is a little bit shy of where he was this time this morning. And fourth place is Andrew Rodgy in eighth. But this is all about Rob Holderness in lane two at the moment.
Rob Holderness has represented Wales at the Commonwealth Games in 2010 in Delhi. So he's got a lot of experience behind him. He's trained a lot in America, and he is winning this semi-final by about 3 or 4 metres going into the final turn.
Well, his personal best, 2:11.85. He needs to improve on that by 0.18 of a second in the final. Of course, get in the top two tomorrow night to get there. But I was just amazed by his time this morning, just thinking, well, maybe he's off form. But he said he isn't off form here. Now, the question is, can he hold on to this for the remainder of the 25 metres to come, Ross?
Craig Benson is coming through, as is Russell Smith in lane six. It's going to be very tight in the finish between Rob Holderness and Craig Benson, but at the minute, it does look like Rob Holderness is going to hold on for the win.
Led from the front all the way through to the end. This has been a gutsy swim by Rob Holderness. Is it going to be a personal best? It certainly is. 2:11.71 for Rob Holderness. That is closing in on that qualifying time of 2:11.67. Adam Peaty, 2:12.27. That's a massive PB. That's a 3-second PB for Adam Peaty, believe it or not. And Craig Benson, 2:12.52. Another personal best for him. So all the top three there doing new personal bests. And that's really encouraging. What strength we have in British breaststroke, both 100 and 200.
We certainly do. Rob Holderness, doing PB just outside the qualification time for the World Championships. He'll be hoping to do that in the final tomorrow night. Adam Peaty did a fantastic swim from the from City of Derby Swimming Club. Do you know who their assistant coach used to be?
Let me guess. Would his initials be RD by any chance?
Certainly was. It's all down to the assistant. No, Adam's a great lad, and you know, he works. He's working with Mel Marshall, a former two-time Olympian, and she's doing great things with Adam. He got a silver medal in the 50, and now he's easily through to the final tomorrow night on the 200. I can see his best chance being on the 100, and I'd put a little bit of money that he could go and win that 100 metres breaststroke later on in the week.
We will see. We will see. That was semi-final number one. Two followed logically. Yeah, you worked it out for yourself, haven't you, by semi-final number two. That's how these things roll. And we have the two Bath teammates side by side, the two Olympic finalists side by side in lanes 4 and 5. Andrew Willis and Michael Jameson. There you go, and there they are. Willis says Bracknell, and Jameson says Edinburgh. They both train together in Bath. I know it's confusing, but that's where they train. Willis and Jameson, 4 and 5, and in this field, well, they're all but trying to catch those two. Very impressive swim by Willis this morning in the heats.
Willis had a fantastic year last year, qualifying for the 200 metres breaststroke at the Olympic Games. There was an outside chance of a medal. He was in the race with only one length to go, and Michael Jameson came through to snatch that silver medal, and Andrew Willis just faded towards the end. But he would have got a lot of confidence and a lot of experience out of that, and hopefully we can see him really push on now over the next 3 years.
Got to say, the times in the world are not that challenging in terms of the top five, because if Andrew Willis did his personal best, he would be ranked number 2 in the world right now. So as long as they can do what they did last year, both Jameson and Willis will be happy. But hasn't moved on massively in 2013. Kevin Cordes of the USA has the fastest time, 208.34. But Willis's season's best is 211, but his personal best is 208.47. Of course, Michael Jameson's been sub 208, is what he did in the final. It was a brilliant progression and procession, really, for Michael. Personal best in the heats, personal best in the semi-finals, personal best in the final to win that silver medal, only beaten, of course, just by Daniel Guerta. Had there been a couple more meters there, Ross, I think he would have been a gold medalist, not a silver medalist.
Yeah, certainly. It was almost down to one more stroke and he would have got that gold medal and probably would have broken the world record. Fantastic swim from Michael Jameson last year, as was Andrew Willis. And it is Andrew Willis at the moment. It's about half a body length up after 75 meters.
I have to say, just look at the strokes here. Andrew Willis now has really honed his stroke to perfection, but I still think Michael Jameson has the most aesthetically nice breaststroke of all of our swimmers. Andrew works very hard and is ahead of his team at the moment, but I just think there's something very pleasing about the way Michael Jameson does his stroke.
It certainly is. These guys will train day in, day out next to each other. They'll know what each other is capable of. Michael Jameson just turned second. He actually turned slower than Rob Holdinghus did in the previous semi-final. So expect Michael Jameson to come back quick. But at the minute, this is Andrew Willis taking this race to the rest of the guys.
Did say how impressive Willis looked this morning. He's looking very impressive in this second semi-final. And Michael Jameson's going to have to do a lot over the last 50 to overcome and overhaul his teammate. 208.47 is not really in range for Andrew Willis today, but 211.42 is his season's best for Andrew Willis. And I don't think Michael Jameson's going to catch him, if anything. I think Willis is keeping that gap, if not bigger. But here comes Jameson. Left it too late, you think?
He probably has, but they're probably just stroking it out now. And they know they're going to qualify for tomorrow night's final. But Andrew Willis is certainly going to lay down a marker, not only to the rest of the guys in this field, but also to the rest of the world.
This is going to be pretty quick, you know, for a semi-final. This is not a bad time at all. 209.82 for Andrew Willis puts him fifth in the world on a semi-final swim. 209.82 for Willis, 211.30 for Jameson. Maybe the roles will be reversed this year. Andrew Willis is looking impeccable.
Yeah, he is. He looked brilliant from the moment he dived in. He led that race. Michael Jameson was always tailing him. Be interesting to see how much effort Michael Jameson put into that semi-final. He knows he's going to make the final tomorrow night. Andrew Willis has laid down the marker to the rest of the world there. Can see that underwater phase from Andrew Willis and Michael Jameson, using about 10 metres underwater, coming to finishing on a full stroke, and that is, as you said, Bob, the top five times in the world this year.
And he'll improve on that, I'm sure, tomorrow. We'll expect Michael Jameson to go quicker than 2:11.30, but you know, we could have two swimmers in the top five in the world going to Barcelona here.
Yeah, you're right. If you just cast your mind back to about 14 months ago, oh, hold on a minute.
He's been DQ'd on the board. He has been disqualified. Andrew Willis has been disqualified. Now, that is an absolute bolt from the blue. He will not believe it. We don't believe it. He'll obviously want to know why. There's his teammate, Michael Jameson. Big shake of the head. He will be absolutely distraught by that. All the work he's put in this year. And Andrew Willis, was it too many dolphin kicks? Ross, we can only kind of surmise here, but what do you think?
I have no can only be either off the start doing a dolphin kick or touching with one hand. But you can see there he's got a beard. He wasn't fully rested and shaved for this, or certainly wasn't fully shaved for that semi-final. So there's plenty more for him to come into the final, but he's not going to be there. He's absolutely shocked. He doesn't know why he's got disqualified. He's just set the top five time in the world this year, and he isn't going to the World Championships.
Just been told a faulty stroke. Ross, can you explain that? A faulty stroke?
Unless the referee gives a bit more indication on what it was, no. I don't know what it's getting explained now by the referee, and he's not going to take it. He's not going to take that very easily at all. You can see he's got a beard on then.
Is there an appeal coming, do you think?
I'm certainly going to appeal that decision. There's his assistant coach down in Bath. They're going to put an appeal in for sure, because he's Andrew Willis's main event is a 200 metres breaststroke. He's not normally a 100 metre breaststroker, so on that form, he isn't going to make the World Championship team. There's going to be people that beat him on the 100 probably, because his main event is a 200 breaststroke.
Well, we'll let you know if the appeal will probably be heard after the session, I imagine, because it won't have an impact on tonight. But he's been DQ'd, so Michael Jameson is the winner. Sue 11.30, Paul Sutherland in third place there. Oof. That's really big news and bad news for Andrew Willis. We will tell you more when we can find out a little bit more during the course of the session. That's a top five time in the world. He will be absolutely mortified by that. Hopefully, before we go off air, we'll be able to tell you some more and tell you whether the appeal is going. Let's return you to the studio after that rather devastating news and see what Kate Gray has to say about things up there. Kate.
Well, that breaststroke 200 metres men's race never fails to let us down with surprises, and I really do feel for Andrew Willis. A DQ next year name is the last thing you would want in the lead-up of a qualification meet, but it means that Michael Jameson has got a chance to really hit it hard in the final, and we will find that out later on tomorrow. But we've just seen the presentation for the 200 metres backstroke, where Lizzie Simmons took the gold medal, and as you can see there, we have the medal ceremony for the which race is that? Is the 200 metres backstroke? Yes, that's correct. And no, it's the 100 metres breaststroke, I think. We've got the 100 metres breaststroke medal ceremony there. We're moving through it very quickly. Stacey Tadd taking the silver medal there from the University of Bath. And then Sophie Allen, who has had a very busy week, hasn't she, so far, Ross?
Very busy and very successful so far. Sophie's swimming really, really well. The whole place is stunned from that disqualification of Andrew Willis. But these girls certainly Sophie Allen, swam very, very well there.
And I think we've also got one more medal ceremony coming up after this. But let's think of the breaststroke. It's all very much about the stroke. And as you've just seen there, disqualification means that his stroke was not correct. Andrew Willis's stroke was not correct. We saw the clips of him talking to the referee. Not happy at all.
No, he's not going to be happy at all. You know, he's been training ever since the Olympic Games, 11 and a half months ago, for this moment to represent his country at a World Championship. Something wasn't right. The referee picked it up. They're saying it's a faulty technique with his stroke, so who knows, there's going to be an appeal I'm sure from his coaches, but that's a major blow, not only for himself but for Great Britain. He's in the top five in the world this year, and he's not going to be able to represent his country at the World Championships in Barcelona.
I know we can only speculate, but what's faulty about? We were just saying that, well, I heard Bob say that he thought MJ's stroke was slightly smoother, but it seems unusual this far into his career that he gets pulled up for something.
It's such a major meet like the trials. You can see there he doesn't know he's been disqualified. He's happy with his time, and you know he comes out 30 seconds later. He's been disqualified. He's going to be shocked. I can see now the coach of Bath. You can see over there the coach of Bath is having a word with the referee. Also, Bill Furness is having a word with the referee, because that's one of his best swimmers out of the World Championship. That's a medal opportunity gone.
Well, we will definitely find out a little bit more about that as the night unfolds and as the week unfolds. But as you can see here, we've got the men's 200 metres butterfly medal ceremony here. And I have to mention, Michael Rock's not in that medal ceremony, is he, Ross? So he won't be on the plane to Barcelona for the 200 metres butterfly, which is quite an unusual decision for him to make.
Yeah, Michael Rock's been one of the mainstays in the 200 metres butterfly for the last 4 or 5 years. He chose to do the heats. He put a very, very fast time in. The time he did in the heats would have got him a silver medal in that event. But he's obviously concentrating on the 100, which is later on in the week, and he's hoping to qualify on the 100, not the 200 this year.
And Joe Robert looked like he's got a smile back on his face now, so he's obviously taken into account what's happened with the tough time of not making the qualification and moving on, and I guess that's what Andrew Willis is going to have to do as well. But we have lots more still to come for you here, and we've got semi-finals coming up, including the women's 200 metres freestyle semi-finals coming up with the likes of Caitlin McClatchy, who did a great time this morning, just missing out on getting under that 2-minute marker, so we'll look forward to seeing how she does there, as well as Eleanor Faulkner back in the pool again following on from her 800 metres freestyle. I wonder how she's recovered, because she's going to have to pick the speed up a little bit more. So let's hand back over to Bob to find out how those 200 metres freestyle finals unfold.
And before we look at this, I can tell you that Bill Furness, the National Performance Director, is talking to the judges right now about Andrew Willis's race. So I think there will be some developments before too long. He is actually talking to the referee now about that. He cannot afford to lose somebody of the caliber of Andrew Willis from the World Champs. Eleanor Faulkner is the second fastest qualifier going into the semi-finals of the 200 freestyle. And of course, as we've already seen today, she has booked her place on the team in the 800. She's back for more in the first semi-final, Ross, of the 200 freestyle.
Yeah, that's right. There's quite a few ladies that we've seen already tonight. Ellie Faulkner, obviously, I've just said, Hannah Miley's just come out of that 400 metres IM, as well as Amy Wilmot in lane 7.
So that was your 1-8. Give you a bit of time to digest all that. Daniel Stewart back again. Sasha Matthews in 2. Hannah Miley back, of course, straight away, as referred to by Cassie early in 3. Ellie Faulkner and Bachmann. Emma Saunders. Amy Wilmot back after her 400 IM in 7. And Laura Whittaker. So we have a few people already qualified in this race for other events. Hannah Miley's on her way. And Amy Wilmot also on her way, and Ellie Faulkner. So three already in the British team competing in the first semi-final of the 200 freestyle.
We can see Anne Bachmann in lane 5. She was a breakthrough swimmer in 2010 at the Commonwealth Games. She was only 15, 16 at the time. She kind of went off the boil in 2011, but she'll be looking to really put those performances, or those couple of years in the doldrums, away from her and really get onto this World Championship team this year.
So Anne Bachmann at the 75-metre mark is being tracked all the way by Ellie Faulkner to her left-hand side. It's not Ellie's best event, as we saw earlier on. She's more of an 800 specialist, but she's keeping her company as they come into the halfway stage. It's those two pretty much out on their own. Hannah Miley will make her move, I'm sure, pretty soon. She's in third place at the turn. The split time for Anne Bachmann, 57.82. Her personal best is 159.07.
And saw a great turn from Hannah Miley going the whole, 7 metres underwater, really caught up with Ellie Faulkner in the lane above her. But this is Anne Bachmann that's leading this race with just over 65 metres to go. She's probably about a quarter of a body length ahead going into the final turn.
I'd say it's a very tough qualifying time for the World Championships here. 157.98 is a qualifying time, and there's nobody in this field has actually done that time, Ross.
No, that is a quick time. We've seen some of the times that have not been that quick, but certainly the 200 metres women's, that is a very, very quick time. And at the minute, Anne Bachmann is still winning this race with 25 metres to go, but Ellie Faulkner's right on her shoulder, if not taking the lead now.
She's a great racer, is Ellie Faulkner, and she's proving that here. She's going to overtake Anne Bachmann over the last 25. And she's going to come in and touch. Now, can she do a time? There's a personal best. Not quite. 159.50 for Ellie Faulkner. Second to Anne Bachmann. Third, Hannah Miley. All of them have been under 2 minutes before. And Hannah Miley just outside it this time. And fourth place going to Sasha Matthews of Nova Centurion. So there's a lot of work still to be done for them to get down to the 157s. Maybe we'll see somebody in that kind of range in semi-final number 2. But I think this is probably the toughest qualification time in all the events we've seen so far.
Yeah, certainly so far. But in the second semi-final, we see Caitlin McClatchy going in lane 4. She's represented Great Britain at the last 3 Olympic Games. So she's got a chance of going under that time. But as we see the girls coming into the final 5 metres, Ellie Faulkner got her head down, touched the wall first, but she's going to have to go a lot quicker if she wants to be considered for the 200 metres freestyle individual in Barcelona.
Here comes the details of what has just been achieved. And of course, it's a semi-final swim, and they need to improve a bit on these times to get close to their World Championship time. Faulkner, Bachmann, Miley and Sasha Matthews in fourth place. Right, semi-final number two, and we have two swimmers who've done the time, and one of those is Becky Turner, City of Sheffield. She's on 156 because she made the Olympic team off the back of that last year. She was maybe one of the surprise inclusions in that team last year.
Yeah, she's an incredibly tough competitor. She always gives it an absolute all, and she is somebody that you can really rely on, whether it's in a relay situation or an individual. We spoke a little bit about Caitlin McCatchy. She's one of the oldest members now on the Great Britain team, but she has a wealth of experience behind her. And between lanes four and five, between Caitlin and Becky Turner, that's where you could expect the win to come from. Just on that lane six, Sophie Smith is an improving youngster. Every time she gets into the pool, whether it's a 200 metres freestyle or 400 metres IM or 200 metres IM, she's improving every single swim. So watch out for her, if not this race, but in the rest of the week and in the next coming years.
Well, I can tell you why the qualifying time is 157, because a lot of the world is doing 155 at the moment. So, you know, anybody doing 159 is probably not even going to make the semi-finals if they made the Barcelona. And the British record is 155.54, held by the now retired Joe Jackson.
Yeah, that's right. 155.54 from Joe. Joe is a member of the team. She competed at the last three Olympic Games. World Championship medalist, Olympic medalist, Commonwealth medalist. You know, she's got the whole bag, really. And she'll be missed, especially on the relay team for Barcelona in the next coming years. But hopefully Caitlin and Becky Turner can really take this event forward, going into certainly the World Championships this year.
Well, this certainly should all be about the new breed coming through. And we have a little problem with the timing device, so I can give you a run through of 1-8 leisurely. Sean Morgan of Edinburgh University will go in lane number one. Swansea University's Libby Mitchell in two. Personal best 201.92, so again, one of those looking to get on the cusp of 2 minutes or hopefully break it. Shauna Lee of Hatfield is 17 years of age, going in 3, 201.55. She's just outside that this morning in qualification. Caitlin McClatchy, 156.62. I think that's either the second or third fastest time ever by Brit in this event. Becky Turner in 5, Sophie Smith 6, Jess Lloyd 7, and Rachel Williamson 8. That's your 1-8. Of course, the top eight times qualify for the final of the 200 freestyle tomorrow night. Let's see how this race unfolds. Kelly McClatchy, of course, expert at 100 and pretty good at 200 as well, Ross.
Yeah, and going back to 2005, she got a world bronze medal in the 400 metres. So a great wealth of experience that Caitlin has in lane four. But just look out for Sophie Smith in lane six. It looks like she's going to be turning around about third or fourth in this first 50.
Caitlin McClatchy, 27.98 for Edinburgh University these days. Seems rather odd to say that when she spent so long down at Loughborough. City of Sheffield's Rebecca Turner in second. Third is Shauna Lee. And fourth is Sophie Smith. That could all change, and probably all will change, over the last 100. Who's going to get into the wall first? Well, the real side-by-side race is between Caitlin McClatchy and Becky Turner. And Caitlin McClatchy, with Shauna Lee coming right into a slipstream there. And at the turn, it was just Caitlin McClatchy by 13 100ths of a second from Shauna Lee in third.
We've seen Caitlin represent the University, Loughborough University, for the last 9 years. Moved to Edinburgh now. She used to be coached by Ian Armiger, who is sunning himself at the minute with his laptop on the beach watching the coverage in the Cayman Islands.
Afternoon or evening, Ian. It must be evening, I imagine. Are you behind us, Cayman Islands? Yeah, I think you probably are. So whatever time of the day it is, welcome to you. We're missing you here. We're missing your big drum. You take your big drum with you.
We can see now that it is Rebecca Turner that's taken the lead. Caitlin's closely behind in second position, but just over 30 metres to go. It's Rebecca Turner in the first position, followed by Caitlin McCatchy and Sophie Smith in third.
Season's best for Becky Turner, 158.72. She's going to lead Caitlin McClatchy home. And Sophie Smith has made a very, very good finish here. But I think Turner is just turning off the afterburner to ease in for a time of 159.08. Not overly strenuous for her. Caitlin McClatchy, 159.60. Third place for Sophie Smith. Bang on the 2 minutes. So a personal best for her. And Shauna Lee, 201.41. That's a new personal best. A couple of personal best there for Shauna Lee and for Sophie Smith. And job done for Rebecca Turner and for Caitlin McClatchy.
So they'll be in the final tomorrow night, fighting it out for the individual spots. You can see them going into the final turn.
Becky Turner just out in front. You see the underwater from Sophie Smith going a good 7 metres underwater, catching up with the other girls, and that's a fantastic swim from Sophie. A PB right on 2 minutes, so hopefully she can go under that magical 2 minute mark tomorrow in the final.
Good for Celia Sheffield, good for Becky Turner. Already seen, of course, Ellie Faulkner make it through, and she'll make it through to the final of this. They both will. And here is the result of semi-final number two. Turner, McClatchy, Smith, all with the times that will take them through to the final tomorrow night. Coming up very shortly, we will bring you the men's 200 metres freestyle. The likes of Robbie Rennick, James Guy, Ian Lloyd will all be involved in that. It'll be interesting to see how that one shakes up, because Robbie Rennick looking for a 400 metre freestyle and 200 freestyle double. Robbie Rennick going in the semi-finals. So the men's version of that coming up very shortly, Kate.
Thank you very much, Bob. You're doing a sterling job over there with all the drama going on. You're keeping up to date with it all, and we love that. And you did mention that we saw Bill Furness down there talking to the referees about the disqualification of Andrew Willis in the 200 metres breaststroke. And conveniently, we spoke to Bill Furness and Chris Spice, two of the most important people in British swimming at the moment. Obviously, Chris Spice being the National Performance Director, newly appointed this year, and Bill Furness being the head coach, newly appointed this year. He's clearly being a very proactive approach to swimming, as we've just seen right there. So let's go and see what Ross found out when he interviewed them earlier on today.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm here with the new head coach, Bill Furness, and the new performance director, Chris Spice, the new venture of British swimming. So, Chris, how has it been coming into a completely new sport as in swimming?
Thanks, Ross. Really challenging. I think from my point of view, I've had some great meetings across the nation with various people, but the pleasing thing for me is that we've got some great staff and we've certainly got some talent in this country, and I'm really looking forward to working with everyone.
Chris, you've come from a completely different sport in basketball. How is the mood coming into British swimming after what was been well perceived as a difficult Olympic Games?
Yeah, I think, you know, it wasn't an easy place to come into, that's for sure, but equally, I think we've been able to identify plenty of things to do and get our hands dirty quickly. I think we're now starting to look at the gaps and where we can add some value across the whole program. But from my point of view, I'd rather have that than have a situation where there's not much to do.
Yeah, exactly. And we've seen some great racing already, Bill. What are the plans going to be moving forward into Rio?
The plans really are to focus the funding more directly on performance. So we've had a funding cut. I mean, that's not ideal, but it's not a major problem. We're still a well-funded sport, and really it's about value for our money and putting the money that we have got now where the best performers are. So both Chris and I are looking at that as a priority in the next few months, and it'll be a smaller ship, it'll be a tighter ship, but it'll be a performance-funded ship going forwards.
And is that going to be the same for every single year now moving into Rio?
Well, it depends on results. I mean, obviously, if we perform well, then we get funded from UK Sport and they'll look at that favourably. But definitely, a broad brush approach does not work if you're looking at winning Olympic medals and World Championship medals. So it's got to be more direct, it's got to be more targeted. So we want to certainly stay with that going forwards.
Thank you very much for your time, guys. Really appreciate it.
Thanks, Ross. Cheers.
So it's all about Rio 2016 there, but before we get on talking about that, we're going to head over to the 200 freestyle semi-finals,
which will contain the likes of Robbie Rennick and James Guy and Lewis Coleman in 3, 4 and 5. Now, Robbie Rennick, off the back of that very impressive 400 freestyle swim last night, is going to halve that distance in what really, Ross, is his favourite event. He prefers this to the 400.
He certainly does. He's very good at the 400, but he'll even admit to you that he prefers to do the 200 metres, and he's world-class at both events. He qualified for the final last year in London. He also qualified for the final in Beijing as well, so he's got a lot of experience, and he'll be looking to go a lot quicker, hopefully, if he qualifies for the World Championships in Barcelona.
He leads at 50, 25.27. Daniel Briggs in the outside lane from City of Manchester Aquatics was second of the turn. Jack Scott in third. Expect Lewis Coleman to make a move, and indeed James Guy in lead three, who impressed us so much in Leeds a couple of months back.
He certainly did. Jack Scott just missed out on the Olympic team last year and actually posted a time that would have qualified him later on in 2012, but unfortunately he didn't do it at the right time. He turns first in 52.72, and it's four or five guys in the line now, with Robbie right in the middle next to James Guy, Lewis Coleman, all going to chase down Jack Scott.
And of course, with the departure of the English record holder to my right-hand side, and indeed David Carey, we need some new names to come through for the men's 4x2 to take their place. Now, could it be Jack Scott? Could it be James Guy? Could it be the likes of Lewis Coleman? Well, with 50 to go, it is Jack Scott who leads. Robbie Rinnick in second, James Guy in third. And fourth is Braxton Timm, who set a PB this morning.
And look at Robbie come through. He's been messing around for three lengths, but he's put the afterburners on. He's flying down this fourth length. For 25 metres to go, he's certainly separated the field. It looks like Jack Scott's going to hang on second place. And James Guy's coming through like a train as well. So it's going to be these three guys going into the final tomorrow night.
Robbie Rennick stops the clock at 147.76. Second place to Jack Scott. Third to James Guy, 148.70. Just outside his personal best. Fourth is Lewis Coleman, 148.91. And that is a brand new and a big one too. Personal best for Lewis. Might get him into the final with that. Braxton Timm, 149.55. And he's improved on his personal best as well. So a little bit further down the field, they are improving their PBs by quite some way. But Robbie Rennick, class act once again.
He certainly was. He turned on the afterburners around about now. He shot through the field and then just switched off with a, oh, you can see this finish. This is not how to finish it. He switched off, but he knew he'd got it in the bag, and he was into the final tomorrow night. In his fast out of the pool, that's not hurt him at all. James Guy also quickly got out of the pool, so he looks like he's fresh as a daisy. And the other guys, they're the two to beat from the first semi-final.
Yep, comfortable enough for Robbie. And let's say some good PBs a bit further down the field as we move through the card there. Rennick, Scott, Guy, and Lewis Coleman probably will all make it. Braxton Timm might have to wait, but 148.9 should be good enough to make that final.
You would expect so. Braxton Timm's also has got an outside chance at 159.55. For the first four in there, you'd think to be going through to the tomorrow night's final.
On we go to semi-final number two of the men's 200 metres freestyle. And here come the one to wait for you. Caleb Hughes, Callum Jarvis, Ian Lloyd. Talking to his coach earlier on, Dave Powell, who just said, well, what happened yesterday with the 400, he just took it too easy and thought he would qualify and didn't expect loads of people to do 350. So he's not out of form, he's not out of shape. He just mistimed his heat swim. And 3.53 just wasn't good enough.
No, he was in the first heat yesterday morning and he completely misjudged it. He looked good this morning in the 200 metres free, not making that same mistake. And as we look at him now physically, he looks in great shape. We just have to see if that relays into the pool and coming out with a good time.
Another of our Olympians. And there are some new names like Nick Granger, for example, who did another personal best. He did a big personal best in the 400 yesterday and did another one in the 200 this morning. Now, I talked to Nick earlier on. Lovely lad, and actually has no idea, his coach says, of just how good he could be. The coach doesn't know, the swimmer doesn't know, and quite frankly, he just goes in and does it. He doesn't think about it, there's no science behind what he does. He just goes and does it. Let's see whether Granger in six can do much. Ian Lloyd, of course, the man to chase, the man to catch here, should be in lane number four.
Yeah, Nick's had a great start in lane six, as had Ian, but also Callum Jarvis in lane two has also had a fantastic start. He really came through last year, Callum Jarvis did on the 200 metres freestyle. Normally a backstroker, but he actually turns first now on the 200 metres freestyle with 1:50 gone.
25.23 that turning time. Ian Lloyd in second, Nick Granger in third, and fourth is Joshua Walsh. But Ian Lloyd is looking very good, very smooth. But look at the lad in lane number six, Nick Granger. He's just going for it here, and so too is Callum Jarvis. But it is Granger who, certainly Russ Barber, the City of Sheffield coach, told me about him about 2 months ago. He said, you know what, this lad is so, so talented. He doesn't know how talented he is. And, well, he did, what, 149.9 this morning. I think he's going to beat that tonight.
You'd expect after that 100-metre split of 52, but in a minute, it's the experience of Ian Lloyd coming through in lane four.
expect Josh Walsh to come back incredibly quick. He always goes out, he tends to go out very, very slow, but comes back strong. But at the minute, it is Yian Lloyd and it is Callum Jarvis, 1 and 2 with only 50 metres to go.
Third place to Joshua Walsh. Nick Granger just dropping back into fourth. Will they be able to pick it up in this last 50? We'll wait and see, but it is all about Yian Lloyd. Very smooth stroke, one of the most talented swimmers that Dave Haller says he's ever worked with. You can see why he's making this look so effortless. There's loads of splash from everybody else and hardly any from him. But Callum Jarvis wants to win this, and Callum Jarvis is going to win it for Bath University in 1:48.01. Yian Lloyd in second, third Joshua Walsh, Nick Granger in fourth, and he has just taken almost a second off his personal best. And fifth to Stephen Mills. So everybody pretty much improving. Callum Jarvis has never gone 1:48 before. 1:49.33 was his personal best. Massive PB for him. Yian Lloyd, of course, we know can do a 1:47, not today. And Joshua Walsh, 1:48.51. That's a second PB. Nick Granger's done nearly a second PB. And Stephen Milne has done a half a second PB. All that on that list there.
You can see Nick Granger just squeaking into the final tomorrow night, 1:49.04. But Stephen Milne misses out on 1:49.11, so incredibly close. It's going to be a tight final tomorrow, that is. Expect Robbie to be out there in front, but who comes second is anyone's guess.
And Nick Granger taking the final position there.
Lots of great swimming there in the 200 metres freestyle. We have the multi-classification races coming up next. But before that, we always hear a lot about what the coaches have said, or we speak a lot about them, but we never actually hear from them. Well, that's changed here on the Fast Lane. We're going to be hearing from lots of the coaches. And first up this week, we have John Rudd from Plymouth Leander, and I caught up with him earlier. I'm joined by John Rudd, the head coach of Plymouth Leander and director of swimming at Plymouth College, and he's responsible for one of the most successful age group and youth programmes in Great Britain. What's your secret, John?
Well, I can't say there's one particular secret. I think it's getting as many ducks in a row as you can in any one particular season. One of the key things I think we've got right in Plymouth has been developing partnerships with other establishments to help develop the club. So we've had a strong relationship with Plymouth College for the last 10 years. And we're now moving into the realms of working with the University of Plymouth and University of St Mark and St John in Plymouth to develop senior swimming scholarships at an elite level, 18+. And when you start putting all of those things together, along with, you know, I've got a great coaching team and great support staff, fantastic athletes that walk through the door, great resources, it's very hard not to be successful.
You've been doing this job for such a long time now. How do you keep yourself going? How do you keep yourself into it and the passion?
You know, I'm always looking for that, you know, that next golden nugget that walks through the door and someone that excites you and makes you think, wow, you know, this is what a great job to work in. And every year there always seems to be somebody else and someone else that's exciting. And obviously in 2012 it was Ruta, and she's continued doing great things since then. And then Ben stepped up at this meet and done fantastic things. And, you know, I think I'm really fortunate to work with two of the most exciting young athletes in the country. Unfortunately, only one of them's British, but they're both very exciting.
We'll talk about Ben in a moment, but let's focus on Ruta and what impact she's had on the club and Plymouth as a whole.
Well, the impact has been fairly small, believe it or not. It's been a... You know, when you've got Tom Daley in our city, it's very, very hard to trump anything he does because he's so famous. And the fact that Ruta isn't British... We've just been able to get on with things, and it's been fairly quiet, even though she's an Olympic gold medalist. Now, I think if we were coaching her in Lithuania, it'd be crazy and almost unmanageable. But we're in this great situation where people of Plymouth know her, but she can walk down the street and she can go shopping and not get hassled. And that's been really, really useful. Has it had an impact on the programme? Yes. I mean, everybody looks up to her, and she, along with Ben, you know, they're two of the most professional kids that I've ever worked with. They do everything right. They're meticulous, every attention to detail. So, you know, I'm really, really pleased that she's been able to do that for us as a program, and she just keeps getting better, which is great.
So let's focus on Ben. He did a brilliant swim last night in the 50 freestyle, doing a qualification time. Obviously, that doesn't mean he's on the team yet, but it puts him in good stead. What's he like in training? Is he a real committed soul?
Oh, absolutely. You know, he's a coach's dream in so many senses. And, you know, that sprinters have a bit of a reputation worldwide for being difficult to manage, and Ben isn't like that. You know, he's a regular guy, just gets on with things, and and as I say, is an example to everybody else. And he's started the sport fairly late, which again, you know, is good news for people out there. When we look at long-term athlete development, and if you haven't started at a certain age, you're not going to make it. You know, Ben pushes the boundaries on that a little bit, and so yeah, he's a fantastic chap to work with, and so much time left to get even better. You know, I think statistically he's the fastest 18-year-old of all time worldwide.
Because in sprint.
Back live with action from women's 200 metres freestyle final for the S14s now. Who's an S14? Jessica Jane Applegate, Ross Davenport. What kind of time is she going to do here?
Goodness knows what time she's going to do. Every time she gets into the pool, it's above 1,000 points. She's an absolute delight to watch. And this, she's absolutely destroyed this field so far. She's probably around about 12 metres ahead coming up to the finish.
Well, her British record is 2:12.21. Can she do it? Yeah, of course she can. 2:11.47. It is a new British record for Jessica Jane Applegate. 1,071 points every time she goes in the pool. Pretty much, you can expect a British record from her, and she has done it yet again. Natalie Massey, 9:06. 8:15 for Regan Doyd. These are all S14, so we know this is clear cut for Jessica Jane Applegate. Not that we ever would doubt it with a world record or a British record for her, but 1,071 points, 2:11.47. She makes it look so easy, and there's talk, Ross, about her trying to qualify in able-bodied events.
Yeah, that's right. One of her targets is to qualify for the national championships in the able-bodied. And the way she's progressing and the way she's moving on forward, there's no reason why she can't do that. She's still incredibly young, and she's just smashed the British record. I was talking to her earlier about what colour hair she's going to dye her hair. She wants to go pink. Apparently now it's purple. It looked pretty pink to me. But she's got to wait in case her hair falls out.
Confirmation for you, 1,071 points, a new British record, new fastest time in 2013 in the world. That's pretty good, isn't it, going into Montreal in a few weeks' time. 2:11.40. So look how much she's won that by. She's won that by 8 seconds.
Yeah, she's certainly going to be the one to beat in Montreal if she carries this form going forward. We saw her at the British Gas International meet in Leeds in March, and she... Well, heat, semi-final, final, whatever she did, it was over 1,000 points. She comes here in Sheffield. This is not the main competition for the disability athletes. Over 1,000 points, nearly 1,100 points. You know, where can this girl go? What boundaries has she got? It's the way it looks now, absolutely none. And she can go into the 1,200-point mark.
I am joined with the PB machine, Jessica Jane Applegate. Fastest time in the world this year. How are you feeling?
I'm like really impressed with that, because I put as much effort as that into I did in the heats.
We've got Montreal coming up in a couple of weeks, well, in a couple of months. How are you feeling, your preparations going for that?
That's actually really gave me a good confidence boost, knowing that I can do that in heavy training.
Definitely. PBs in heavy training, everybody wants to do that. Let's have a round of applause for our gold medalist, Jessica Jane.
Very, very impressive, as indeed she is all the time. And we don't often hear from her, but she's getting more confident in interviews as now as well.
She certainly is. She mentioned then that she's still in hard training. So we're talking that she's going nearly 1,100 points in hard training. This, well, we spoke about earlier that, you know, the ceiling is not her limit. You know, she can go beyond that and just go, the world's her oyster.
Hashtag BGSC13 if you want to get in touch with us via Twitter. And thanks to all of you around the world. It has been around the world who've been involved with us during the course of the day. And, of course, we're here all the way through to the end. I hope you're enjoying it. And there's been some very good swims, a few not quite so good swims. But Jessica Jane Applegate showing the way home in the multi-classification. Let's go on to the next of the S14 and S5 races, because Andrew Mullen snuck in there in lane zero, but all the S are S14s. Scott Quinn, Craig Harris, Craig Rogge, Ben Proctor, all of those on that list are S14s in the 200 metres freestyle final on multi-classification. For Andrew Mullen sneaking in there. He's going to be a little bit slower than everybody else, but of course, yesterday he had to swim on his own as well.
Yeah, he's the only one in an S5, but he'd be
thankful of the company. Yesterday he had to do the heats and the final on his own, and he had to break the British record to get a gold medal, and unfortunately he was just shy of that. So at least he's got another seven competitors to race against.
Ready to go, Ben Proctor in the centre there, in lane number four. Jack Thomas also going in this competition. The British record is held by Ben Proctor. 201.97 is the time. The S14s only came back into the Paralympics last year after a 12-year hiatus because of those naughty basketball boys in Sydney 2000, stopping them competing in Athens and Beijing. But they came back. So they're underway. 200 freestyle, and the last to finish most definitely will be Andrew Mullen, the S5 in zero, but we'll keep tabs on all the S14s as they are racing head-to-head here.
It's going to be great to see seven guys all in the same category going head-to-head with just Andrew Mullen in S5 category out in lane zero. So you can easily find out the clear winner from the S14 category because it will be whoever touches the wall first.
Did Dan Pepper a disservice? I'm sorry, he holds the British record at 201.27. Not Ben Proctor, but Dan would never forgive me. That was set in Reykjavik in October 2009. So the time they're looking for that British record is 201.27. That's what they're looking for. And leading the way, as expected, Ben Proctor, who's been pretty close to that time. Maybe today's the day that Ben does take that British record.
Yeah, he's 4 metres ahead already in the halfway mark. Absolutely flying at the minute. Like we said, these are all S14 categories, so he is racing like for like here, and he's just extending his lead. He's really brought his leg kick in, and he's got 75 metres to go.
Seeing Dan Pepper around, but obviously deciding not to do this. In case you missed the lineup, Andrew Mullins, S5, all the others, Scott Quinn, Craig Harris, Craig Rodgey, Ben Proctor, Jack Thomas, Joseph Schenk, and Ryan Nichols are all S14s, but the man they have to catch, and he is not holding back here, is Ben Proctor. Look at the gap he's already got in this race. He is 2.5 seconds between 4 and 5. Let's keep tabs on Andrew Mullin in lane zero and see what he's up to there.
Yeah, Andrew Mullin's coming up to about 75 metres to go. He's the only S5 in this category, but there's no doubt who the winner's going to be in lane four. Ben Proctor, absolutely flying at the minute, still about 5 metres ahead going into the last 10 metres.
Remember that time we're looking for 201.27. I think he's just going to be outside it, is he? Yes, he is. 201.55, 9.5, 3 points, but that is a very, very good time. It is also a personal best time for Ben Proctor, 9.53 points for him. 8.88 for Craig Rodgey, that's beaten by Jack Thomas with 8.94. As we go back to Andrew Mullen, his personal best in this event is 2.55.05. Qualifying time of 2.59.94. There's the winner of the S14 category, Ben Proctor.
Andrew Mullin's got about 15 metres to go of this 200 metres freestyle. He is the only one in this category. He's probably got coming up to about 10 metres to go. He's working incredibly hard. Crowd are cheering him in. 5 metres to go. Andrew Mullin's going to touch the wall in a time of 2.57.40, which gives him a point of 5.63. So it is Benjamin Proctor with a score of just 9.53 to take the win in the S14 category.
Yeah, Ben Proctor is the winner on that. 9.53 from him, 8.88 from Rick Rodgey, and this is how he did it.
Yeah, you can see there he's 4 or 5 metres off on going into the last turn. Incredibly good swim, PB swim there from Ben Proctor. Coming to the last 5 metres now, going to keep the, oh no, has a breath. Last five, something he needs to work on in training. If you can keep your head down the last five, that's what's desirable for a swim. And that's going to probably shave off another couple of tenths of a second. So he's going to be in hard work going into World Championships. That's a great swim.
9.53 points, 201.55. Ben Proctor, Jack Thomas in second, and Craig Rodgers in third place. That's how it finished in the men's 200 metres freestyle. Let's hear from the winner, Ben Proctor, and he is with Cassie Patton.
to place as second reserve in the women's 200 freestyle.
So with me now is Benjamin Proctor, gold medalist. How are you feeling now?
All right.
So how you got Montreal in a couple of weeks. How is your preparation going to be for that?
Just go train hard and that.
Well, you've done a really good time here, very close to your PB. Great job. Let's have a massive round of applause for Benjamin Proctor.
So as you mentioned there, he's still in hard training. So expect that time to tumble when he gets out to Montreal, has a full rest, full shave, and he'll be raring to go in the World Championships in Montreal later on this year.
That's the freestyles done. Let's move on to your favourite stroke, Ross Davenport, the butterfly. Did you ever do butterfly?
I can do it. I can do it. Not to any great standard. I'm sure if we have a race, Bob, I'll just be able to touch you out.
Yeah, I'll probably see me going next Wednesday. 100 butterfly for women coming up. We have a wide range of different disciplines and categories here. So let's go through. You can see them on your screen. Some S9, some S10. That's pretty much all we've got, actually, S9s and S10s. So in a way, we've got two races within one race here. It makes it a little bit easier for you, the viewer, to work out what is going on here. And Amy Marin is back from Romford Town with her qualifying time. A PB in the heats. What else? That's what she does.
She's still only 14 years of age. Cracking young swimmer. Spoke to her early and she was she apologised that she might be a little bit slow here tonight, because she as well, like the rest of the disability athletes, are in hard work. When you are in hard training, it is hard to swim fast. You do need to rest up and rest your muscles if you want to get the best performance possible out of your body. So these swimmers are all in hard work, and expect their times to tumble when they get to Montreal.
S9 British record in the 100 butterfly is Stephanie Millward. A 110.61, and for the S9s and for the S10s, it is Eleni Papadopoulos who's in this race. 110.64 is the time. So in fact, her qualifying time is only 2/100ths outside that. So I wonder if we're going to see the S10 record go here, because it's been on the books for a little while, held by the City of Manchester aquatic swimmer.
Everyone loves to see records broken. It'd be great if she can do it here tonight, here in Pontford, Sheffield. So look out for that record, and hopefully she can put in a great performance and break it.
There's Stephanie Millward in this race. Chloe Buck, Elizabeth Simkin, both S9s. Emma Cattle in S10. Amy Marin, S9. Gemma Armand, S10. Papadopoulos, also S10. Cashmore in S9. Tony Kinney back in the pool again, and S10 in 7. And Alice Tai, S10 in 8. So say we've got quite a few S10s here who'll be racing against each other, but I've got a funny feeling we're going to be looking at lane 5 of the S10s. Papadopoulos and maybe Amy Marin in lane 3. We'll see.
At the minute, it is lanes 3, 4, and 5 that are in a line after about 35 metres.
See how this one shapes up. I say it's good for Gemma Armand and Eleni Papadopoulos. So they are side by side in lanes 4 and 5, and Gemma Armand just gets ahead of Eleni Papadopoulos. So just, in fact, she's almost a second clear of her there. Amy Marin is leading the S9s. She's in second place in the race, and Claire Cashmore is third.
So as long as these girls come first in their category, they'll win their category, but not necessarily win their overall race. The S10s can always get beaten by the S9s. So there is only S9s and S10s in this race, but watch out, because it's whoever touches the wall first and gets the most amount of points.
Well, we see the two S10s going to the wall together, and Gemma Armand is going to pip Eleni Papadopoulos to the touch. Now, what time can she do? 1:10.72. Not quite good enough to take the British record. That is 7:47 for Papadopoulos, 7:56 for Gemma Armand, 8:27 though for Amy Marin. Tops the lot in the S9 category. So the winners in lane 3, Amy Marin. Most points for lane 3, Amy Marin, with 827 points. Only person to get in the 800 range. Second place going to Claire Cashmore in the end with 770. And third to Gemma Armand. So it is Amy Marin in lane 3. There she is. The belle of the ball once again with, is that another personal best? I'm sure before I even look down, I'm sure it's going to, yes, of course it is. Do you know, that's a personal best by almost a second. Yeah, I thought you said she was not feeling very well.
Well, she apologised. She said, oh, I'm ever so sorry that I probably swim slow tonight, but I'm in hard training. Oh, well, you're just going to go in a second PB. So apologise a little bit more, especially when you're going into the World Championships.
She's a young girl, but she's learning how to lie very early on. 827 for her, 770 for Claire Cashmore, and 756 for Gemma Arman. So, yeah, 1:11:10. Her previous best time was 1:12:04.
Should be one of those girls that are lying about their age to say she's older, because she's still only 14 years of age. So many, many girls want to say they're younger, but she certainly is a talent.
Here she is talking to Cassie.
Standing with me is our gold medalist and PB, Amy Marin. How are you feeling after that swim?
I'm really, really happy with that swim, yeah. Obviously, we're in hard training still, so to PB, yeah, I'm over the moon.
It's always good to PB in hard training. So what are you going to be doing over the next couple of months?
It's just going to be working hard again and just practicing the small gains, really.
Well, to get a PB in hard training, hopefully those small gains will make big gains for the summer. So let's have a round of applause for Amy Marin.
What a delight. Another brilliant swim. What's she going to be doing in Montreal? She's just going to be smashing records left, right and centre, isn't she?
She certainly is, but what's she going to be doing in Rio in 3 years' time? Okay. An extremely mature head on young shoulders. Interview was very, very clear, very, very good. And, you know, like I was saying, she's in hard training, so she can just, her world's her oyster, she can go out there and she can go and express herself.
As indeed she did. On to the last event of the evening. And this one will contain five swimmers. We've seen the women's 100 butterfly. This one will have a wide range of selections, including the birthday boy who goes in lane number four. Happy birthday to James Hollis. He'll be representing the S10s, as will Oscar Livesey and Jack Bridge. When you were 19?
Yeah, just about. I actually qualified for my first Olympic Games when I was 19, back in 2004 in Athens. Can you remember when you were 19?
No. Everything was in black and white in those days.
What, you had TVs?
We didn't have colour.
Did you have TV?
Yeah, we had the wireless. I think it was called a, crystal set in those days.
I have no idea what you're on about. Plasma?
I knew you'd say, sorry? Plasma? This is modern language of which you speak. All right, Oscar Livesey in two. Morgan Peters goes in lane three. James Hollis in four. James Clegg in five. So we have quite a wide range here. Well, we have three different categories represented. Morgan Peters doing it all by himself for the S9s. And as far as their best time, the British record is concerned, Morgan Peters is aiming for time in the range of James Crisp's record, which is 104.46. As far as the S10s are concerned, their best time is James Hollis's 59.53. So that's his personal best, that's the British record, and he goes in lane number four.
It's James Clegg that's had the best start in the yellow cap in lane five. He is an S12, his only S12 in this category, and it's Tiz James Hollis in the lane below him in lane four, that's an S10 that's turning second.
First 50 completed, they come back for home. The yellow cap in lane number five belongs to James Clegg from East Lothian Swim Club. James Hollis would like a birthday present of a victory here, and he's doing everything he can to get back on terms with Clegg.
He's looking incredibly strong in his last 15 metres. Every stroke is clawing back. This is going to come right down onto the finish. As we go 5 metres to go, it is neck and neck.
What kind of time can Hollis do just outside his best time? 1:00.32, 800 points for him. 8:47 for James Clegg. 7:34 for the only S9, Morgan Peters. 7:34 and Jack Bridge. It's finished, but the clock has not registered his time yet, so it looks like being James Clegg 8:47 it will be, because James Hollis has got 800, so we can claim quite justifiably lane five is the winner. James Clegg of East Lothian has been just under the minute mark before now, 59.99, but not today. But this is how they went head to head over the last 25 or so. James Hollis and James Clegg like this.
You can see it's incredibly close finish, right on the touch, James Clegg, just pipping James Hollis by just over, just under two-tenths of a second, and taking that win in the meantime with 800 points.
There's confirmation that James Clegg got 847. James Hollis, 1:00:32. Morgan Peters in third, 1:05.65. The outcome of the 100 butterfly, Jack Bridge 6:25, and Oscar Livesey with 468. Let's hear what the winner, James Clegg, has to say. Full deck with Cassie Patton.
So with me now is James Clegg, our gold medalist for that 100 metres butterfly. So how was that race?
It was pretty good for me. I think my turn up, but the second 50 was great.
So you're going to be going to Montreal, the World Championships, in a few weeks. How's your preparation going to be for that?
I think got another couple of weeks of hard training, then going into taper after that, so can't wait.
To do a good swim like that in hard training, that shows that you're going to be good in the summer. So let's have a massive round of applause for our gold medalist, James.
James, your third medal from London 2012. So he, again, one of the youngsters backing up his swims and swimming well even when they're not rested. So just shows what these youngsters can do. Now let's go over to our Twitter feed, hashtag BGSC. And it has been going wild since the Andrew Willis disqualification. A lot of people saying it was a brave decision by the referee. So thank you very much to Victoria Smith for Woking Swimming and Liz Matthews, who have all said they don't agree with Willis being disqualified. And I'm sure we will find out. I've just seen one of his coaches saying they are appealing at the moment. So we will keep you updated with that as and when we find out. We also now have a swim-off coming up. This is the second swim-off of the week. So let's hand straight back to Bob for the 200 freestyle first, second reserve to find out who will make that spot.
And it is Amy Wilmot and Emma Saunders. Now, we were only talking about this with Dave Gregory on pool deck earlier on. Every single time there is a swim-off, the swimmers go more quickly when they have the swim-off than they did when they swam in the semi-finals. Now, I will put a pound to a penny that Amy Wilmot will go faster than 2:02.15 is what she did in the semi-final.
Yeah, the chances are that tend to raise the game in the swim-offs because it's just head-to-head racing. So it's whoever touches the wall first will get that spot. And in the minute, they are racing for second reserve for the final. So if two people drop out tomorrow for the final, one of these girls will get drafted in. This is a horrendous position to be in for a swimmer. You don't want to be doing it again. But Amy Wilmot's already done the 400 medley and the 200 free semi-final and now the swim-off. So if she gets through this, she'll have done very, very well.
Easy, of course, for her to have pulled out and said, no, it's all right, Emma Saunders, you can have it because it's not my main event. But she's hanging on, and perhaps she thinks she can get on the relay team. I don't know. But anyway, her time earlier on, as I mentioned, was 2:02.15. And it is Amy Wilmot who's leading at the halfway stage. Not much between them, a tenth of a second, to be precise, between Amy Wilmot and Emma Saunders. Will both of them, as I predict, go inside their semi-final time?
I'm going to say probably not on this occasion, Bob, but normally you do tend to the step up the game. Just I only say no because they've turned in a 1 minute 0.7 and 1 minute 0.6. So if they're going to go under that 2:02 mark, they're going to have to almost negative split this race.
We will see. And they are racing each other. Perhaps they're just having a little chat as they go along there. What are you doing tonight? Where are you going? Do you like this pool? Yeah. How's the food?
Probably Amy Wilmot. We'll be getting back in and swimming in another event later on.
Yeah, I imagine that she will, but we still don't know who's going to win this because they are still, like they were earlier on in time terms, absolutely side by side. This is quite a cracking race. Probably doesn't mean a whole lot in the grand scheme of things, but these two are not going to yield. They're not going to give this race to each other. And Amy Wilmot and Emma Saunders absolutely side by side. It's going to be Amy Wilmot who gets it. Yeah, you're right. 2:03.09. 1/100th of a second separating Amy Wilmot and Emma Saunders in the air. Yes, they did actually, on a rare occasion, go slower in the swim-off, but they only separated by 1/100th of the end there.
I said Amy Wilmot might have another swim later on tonight, and if they'd have equaled the time again, they would have had to go again. Well, surely one of them would have dropped out. But 1/100th separating them on the second or third time of swimming that race today.
That's like 200 freestyle skins, isn't it?
What a difference. Look at the pain on Amy Wilmot's face. She's done the 400 medley, which is one of the grueling events. She's then, in my opinion, done the hardest event, which is 200 metres freestyle.
You would say that, wouldn't you?
I would say that. And she's had to do it again. And that is just for the second reserve. So she'll be ready for bed tonight.
I think she'll probably sleep before she gets out of the pool, the way the things are looking. But here we go. This is the result of the second reserve swim off for the women's 200 freestyle. Amy Wilmot winning it by 1/100th of a second from Emma Saunders in 2:03.09. I think they're very glad they're not coming back onto the blocks again to do it all again. That's the end of the competition for tonight, and we're going to head back to Kate, and she will be joined by Ross very shortly. So thanks for all your tweets and all your messages tonight, and I'll see you back on day three.
Thank you very much, Bob. Great job there. You cannot get much closer than that. These 1/100th of a second will be making the difference tonight. And as we just saw that swim off, we now go straight into a presentation for the women's 200 metres multi-classification final. And in that final, we had the likes of Jessica Jane Apicott taking the gold, and we had lots of talk about how her hair is pink, purple, who knows these days. And when I chatted to her earlier, she says she's slightly worried that her hair might fall out, like Ross did say, which means that, you know, she's all about the image as well as the swimming. And as you can see there, she's about to receive it. It's kind of a faded red at the moment, not really sure. Let's hope it doesn't have too much of an impact on her performance. And that's the one of many medals she has won this week, and there's much more to come. Just to confirm that Jessica Jane is one of the members on the team going to Canada. It's the World Championships team that they have qualified for. They actually qualified for the World Championships a couple of months ago here in Sheffield. So they've already selected. They can kind of relax and just enjoy the swimming, which appears what they're doing, because there's been lots of great swims, lots of personal bests. And to be honest, this type of racing is very, very beneficial to ensure that they do get to Montreal in the best possible shape. It's going to be 32 swimmers that have actually made that team, quite small, unusually small for a disability team. Along on that team, we have the likes of Eleanor Simmons, we have Joseph Craig, and as you can see in shot there, we have three of our finest S14 lads from Great Britain, and we have the likes of Craig Rodgie there. He's from up in Scotland, and yeah, he'll be loving the fact that he's up on that podium. It's really important for these guys to really appreciate the fact that they're doing well and that they're really stepping up their game. The next one along we have is Jack Thomas, and he's quite a new one on the scene. He trains down in Swansea under the control of Billy Pye, who is also Eleanor Simmons's coach. So obviously he's whacking up some great performances. And then Ben Proctor there on the podium, he looks like he's pleased with that. He's quite a quietly spoken young lad, as we saw speaking to Cassie. He's a man of very few words, but he fights very hard in those races. And I have Ross joining me now, who saw that 200 metres freestyle race. You're a pro at that race. That's what you're all about, the 200 freestyle. And were you impressed with what you saw with those S14 lads?
Yeah, absolutely brilliant. It's great when you can get a group of S14 swimmers so they can all race against each other. And it really did bring out the best of out of them all. And 2:01.5, it's a massive PB. And hopefully he can move that forward into the World Championships and lower that mark even more.
Because you picked up on the point with Bob about how the fact these S14s might start wanting to go for the able-bodied nationals. Now, it's quite a breakthrough for them. It's almost like the Paralympics aren't enough. They're going to keep moving on. But do you think it's mainly about getting great competition? Because maybe here it's not as much as they would like.
Yeah, that's right. You know, there's talk about Jessica Jane wanting to qualify for the national championships later on in the year in the able body, and that'd be great for her. And it'd be great for the sport that we can interact and they can enter the different events as well and really move the para swimming on. And by having that extra competition will help them. So hopefully that will be the case, and hopefully they can get the qualification times in the able bodies.
So we are flying through these presentations, and the next presentation up we have there is the 100 metres butterfly, and we've seen the likes of Gemma Almonds receive the medal. Claire Cashmore, I do have to big up Claire Cashmore, she's my housemate and very good friend of mine. And then finally we have Amy Marin there taking the gold medal. That girl just cannot do any wrong. I think she's actually competing in 5 races in Montreal, and she's breaking European records, British records. We spoke to her earlier and she's like, yeah, I'm just taking it in my stride. I'm not too worried.
Yeah, we said it in the commentary with Bob, you know, wise head on very young shoulders, very, very young shoulders. And it's brilliant for her to come into a competition like this, doing the second PBs and just cracking on with it. And who knows what she can do in Montreal in a few weeks' time.
Now, is there too many races you can do in one event? Because surely there's a certain point where you hit fatigue. I know she's young and she's fresh, but there's got to be some point when you think, actually, this is just too much.
It depends. If that affects her performances in other races, then I'd say yes. But if she can go in and win gold medals in everything she does, then crack on. You know, you see the likes of Ryan Lochte and Michael Phelps in the able body. They have, Michael Phelps won 8 gold medals in Beijing, so he had 8 different events and he still won them all. So it can be done, but you've got to train towards that and you've got to make sure that every time you do swim that you recover well and then move on to the next race.
And we have our final medal ceremony taking place right now. It's the men's multi-classification 100 metres butterfly. As you can see there, we've got James Clegg taking the silver medal. And then up on the top, we have, James Hollis in silver medal, and we've got James Clegg on the top there. He's also got a sister, Libby Clegg, who competes for athletics, is very successful. She's a visually impaired athlete as well. Bit of a family theme going on here. We've seen the two Hind brothers compete this afternoon. Any family connections within the British team with you guys?
Not that I can think of off the top of my head. But yeah, obviously Sam and Ollie Hind are really kind of taking the brotherly sibling rivalry to all the way to the top. Competed in last year in London. I said in commentary, Bob, I have a brother that swam, and he retired from swimming as soon as his younger brother started tapping at his feet. So it's great that the brothers can still carry on swimming and still be doing it for Team GB.
So let's review this evening's session. We've had quite an eventful one, probably the most eventful we've had in a while. What's been the stick-out moment for you?
Well, stick-out moment for me is it's not necessarily a positive one. It's the disqualification of Andrew Willis on that 200 metres breaststroke. Big shock. Hopefully he can get it overturned, but the referee definitely saw something and they got disqualified. So big shock. Hopefully he can bounce back and be very, very positive from this moment forward.
Alexia, let's stay on the positive one with Jazz Carling in the 800 metres freestyle. We've spoken a lot about her Twitter, loving her, kind of being the new Becky, which is kind of what Britain are looking for. We want to find the next great Becky Adlington. Could Jazz Carling be the one?
She certainly can do. Jazz went a time quicker than Becky went last year at the London Olympic Games. A cracking swim. Would have got her a bronze medal last year, but obviously she wasn't there through illness. But she's used that as a motivation of fact, and she's come back even stronger through to this year. Also, we saw Chris Walker-Herbin toppling Liam Tancock in the 100 metres backstroke. That's not been done for 5 or 6 years, so that's a massive swing in British swimming.
And we will be hearing from Chris Walker-Herbin very soon, actually, because we're again having an interview with him, so we'll look forward to that. But moving our way through the programme, a couple of the youngsters may be doing well in the breaststroke. Sophie Allen stepping up her game. Actually, I have a tweet from Sophie Taylor here. She cannot believe she's gone a 108.13 to make the breaststroke final for tomorrow. She's actually just had surgery. She's had a month out the water, and she's come back, and she's taken up. Breaststroke females has always been quite weak, hasn't it?
It certainly hasn't, and we saw tonight Sophie Allen going 107, which has not really been done before in Britain. And also we have it's 4 or 5 girls that are going 108, which is, you were winning this event a couple of years ago on 109, and now you've got 5 or 6 girls going under the 109 and moving that event forward. We need that for the medley relay. We need that for the individual breaststrokers. So that's great things for the female breaststrokers.
And the male breaststrokers never failed to impress. Obviously, we'll forget about Willis for now. We'll focus on the ones that did do well, and that was Michael Jameson, the likes of Craig Benson, and Robert Holderness from the outside lane. He really did step up his game.
Yeah, I think Rob had an easy heat this morning and really put down his marker tonight in the 200 metres breaststroke. Shame for Andrew Willis, but Michael Jameson, I think, was certainly taking his foot off the gas tonight in the semi-final. Expect big things for him tomorrow night in the final.
Well, we've reviewed quite a bit of the finals there, and we'll look forward to what's coming up for tomorrow, and we'll have a look at that. But actually, I want to invite on to the podium Chris Walker-Herbin. He is firing out some guns, and he's very, very happy to be with us tonight. And he's got his hair all styled quite nicely. It's almost like you knew you were coming on TV.
Not at all.
Not at all, no. You were really
set. Just when
this.
I get out of the pool, it's just like this. So it's
I've seen you many times in training. Every time he comes to the wall, he shakes his hair up a bit to make sure it's in place. But hey ho, as long as you swim fast, and that's exactly what you did tonight, Chris. Where did that come from?
I'm not sure, to be honest. I mean, training's been going really well, and you want me to take the mic? Right, I'll take the mic. Yeah, no, training's been going really well. And everyone's asking me where it came from, and I'm not really sure. So, I was hoping for a 53.9, and then to come in last night and go 53.4 was an absolute buzz for me and a real confidence boost. So I just wanted to come in and back it up again tonight and come out on top, which I did, so I'm very happy.
We've seen Liam Tancock own this event for the last 5 or 6 years. You're the first Briton to beat him in a British competition. How does that feel? How does that feel having such an iconic swimmer that you've just beaten?
like I was saying in the interviews after, it's a bit bittersweet, to be honest. I mean, he's been such a good ambassador for the sport and especially for the 100 backstroke. So I didn't really know what to say. Obviously, it's nice to win. Everyone wants to win. But, you know, it's Tanny. Like, you know, I've spent my life growing up idolising him. But obviously, everyone loves to win. So it's a bit bittersweet.
So you've got less than 4 weeks now till Barcelona. Obviously, yeah. Subject to confirmation, you're on the team. What are you going to do in the next 4 weeks to ensure that you can step up again?
We get back on Monday. I think we've got Monday off. And then Wednesday, we fly out to Mallorca for a couple of weeks. You know, bring it back up, 2 weeks hard, intense training. And then, you know, I try and perfect the double taper, bring it back down and hopefully come out firing at Barcelona.
Chris, we normally see you in the 200 metres backstroke. You know, that is probably your main event. But that swim was world-class in the 100. What can we expect in the 200 metres backstroke?
A lot, hopefully. I mean, I still train for it, and it's always been my main event. But obviously, with a swim like that, things might be different now. But, you know, I'm expecting big things in it and hopefully come out on top with a double as well there. But, you know, see what happens.
And your thoughts moving forward for the next 3 years? Obviously, you've got the World Championships being confirmed, your spot on Monday, and then the Commonwealth Games next year, the World Championships, and then into Rio. What are you planning or what are you hoping for over the next 3 years?
I've sat down with Dave and we've come up with a few goals. Like, I'd like to start, you know, finaling at the major meets throughout the years and, you know, potentially getting myself on the podium. But, you know, the goal is to hopefully be stood on that podium in Rio. But obviously, it's a long way away. A lot can change. But, you know, one of my main goals is for next year at the Commonwealth. You want to bring back in the freestyles. You know, I've been out of whack with those for a little while, so it'd be nice to bring those back into my events.
And let's just chat through your team here. You've got the Bath ITC. They seem to have mixed results tonight. We won't probably emphasise too much on the fact that Andrew Willis has been disqualified, but you've had some positive performances as well. As a team, are you feel like training's stepping up and you're all improving together?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you know, I joined Bath years ago in 2009 when there was like three or four people there. So to have a full squad now, and, you know, Sophie Allen had a great 100 breast this evening. Obviously, there's a few disappointing swims, but they've got more swims and, you know, main events to come. So, you know, fingers crossed for that. But now the team's coming along great. There's not a lot more you could ask for in a team. So, yeah, things are moving in the right direction.
Well, thanks for popping up to see us, Chris.
Anytime.
And are you competing the rest of this week?
I'm in on Saturday and hopefully Sunday.
So you can just chill out until then, yeah?
Yeah, a bit shopping tomorrow, maybe.
Go play with your hair, yeah.
I've got to do my haircut.
All right, thanks so much, Chris. And
we wish
you the best of luck for the competition and then Barcelona, hopefully, if you're on the plane.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So, as we can see, we can really appreciate the fact that we've got these athletes coming to talk to us, and that's the exclusive access that the Fast Lane is bringing you. We've had coaches, we've had athletes, all sorts of VTs going out to you, and hopefully you're enjoying your coverage. We do know that we've had a couple of technical hitches, and we hope that you've stuck with us, and we really appreciate all your Twitters. And tomorrow we have a massive guest coming in. We've got Rebecca Adlington joining us here in the studio, so you do not want to miss out. It'll be interesting to hear a review on the 800 freestyle today. Now, just a quick wrap-up of today. I mean, Hannah Smiley-Miley, she really did do a great job, but Amy Wilmot was on her tail.
Yeah, she certainly was, and we saw Amy do two more events after that in the 200 metres freestyle. But Hannah was fantastic in that 400 medley. That's her event. She's, you know, bossed that in Britain for many, many years. But she's now got the likes of Amy Wilmot pushing her all the way. Danielle Lowe had a very good first 300 metres. So expect her to come through over the next 3 years as well. We saw Jazz, absolutely brilliant. The breaststroke boys were fantastic. Just heard from Chris, he was brilliant. So a good night overall with a few little bit mishaps. But, you know, things are looking good and looking forward going into the World Championships.
And what we're looking forward to tomorrow, we want to make sure our audiences come back and join us. The 200 freestyle finals look like they could be interesting.
Yeah, on a personal note, you know, I love watching 200 metres freestyle. It's one I've been a part of for many years. So, you know, Robbie looked great tonight, Robbie Rennick. Jan Lloyd looks like he's put his disappointment on his 400 behind him. He had a great swim. Callum Jarvis was at the University of Bath with Chris Walker-Hebben. He was one of the positives from tonight, from the Bath squad. So he's knocking on the door. You know, it's going to be a great final tomorrow night. A lot of them have already done the qualification time for tomorrow. So expect a really tight, close race in that 200 metres freestyle.
And hopefully we'll have a bit more confirmation on what's going on with the 200 metres breaststroke final with the men, and see a great final there.
Yeah, that's right. You know, we're seeing Michael Jameson did a fantastic swim last year in London. He progressed through the rounds. Hopefully, he had his foot off the gas going into tonight's semi-final. He's the one to beat tomorrow. He is the silver medalist. Hopefully, Andrew Willis can get into that final as well, but that's all subject to an appeal, so we'll have to wait and see. But there'll be somebody nipping at Michael Jameson's heel, no matter who it is, whether it's Andrew Willis, whether it's Rob Holderness or Adam Peaty, you name it, there's a whole host of people queuing up behind him or to beat him going into tomorrow night's final.
Well, thanks for joining us again tonight, Ross. You've done a great job and we will see you over the next few days. That's about all from day two here. We've had lots of drama, we've had lots of tears and but also qualification times. And by my statistics that I've taken down, obviously this is not confirmed, but I've seen about 15 of our British athletes that have done the qualification time to go to Barcelona. So I'm sure that list will grow as the next few days goes on. But I'd like to thank you all for joining us and appreciate that there has been a few technical problems, but you stuck with us and we've had a great time with you here. Just to remind you that you can actually see a couple of the races available on swimming.org if you want to see any of the finals that you missed. And if not, we will see you tomorrow, same time, 5:30. See you then.
Nice and warm when you swim. Got 11 laps left.
It's good enough for him as well. 17:70 for Gordon.
A massive PB in Leeds in May. The speed, but it's, you know, it's good to have that speed, especially.
So Emma Faulkner as well, 8:25. He's away from Gemma Lowe, 29:06. Back in Tancock, getting now. Here's the beast far outside the qualifying time needed. So a little bit more in the tank, hopefully for a run.